are they going round, and what do you think they'll take back from this race?
They'll take a lot back. Obviously, in the field of promotion, this is a little bit like coming to see Juventus play Manchester United when you're fielding for Woking Town or something, isn't it, really? But we love the event. The event's going to grow and grow in Australia. When you've got crowds like that, the atmosphere's there, so the riders ride harder and harder. This year, I'm working on the teams to come out just at New Year, just after New Year, and they can have 2 weeks training, get the miles in, and they're there for the race. And I hope some of the teams will go on to Alan Rushton's Tour Langkawi.
Well, that's the Tour Down Under, which is coming up early next year. Look at the sprint finish here. Whoa! You don't have to see that in Prologue time. Well, I do remember, and that's, hang on, they've got 7.09 up there now, and I'm not quite sure if that is exactly the time for Mickelson that went round, because 7.20 was before, and that could well be what's happened. And so we'll wait for confirmation of that one out there, but our computer's gone on the blink totally. I'm looking up there on the board, it says 7.09, and it looks like Mickelson managed to pop out and get the sprint as he went through. He caught Minali for a complete minute, so it could be it. Well, just waiting for confirmation. That one's 7.09, which is Mickelson, 7.09, after that brilliant performance. That's now got us a new leader on the board, and that previous time we had was 7.20. Well, we're going to get back to work here a moment, but I've got alongside me Ron Webb talking about the Tour Down Under. Don't go just a moment, Ron. We talk about the riders liking it down there. We talk about the people like it, the politicians liked it. What about the press and the media? Because it was, I think, a surprise to many people how big it was. Are you going to get a queue of us chaps traipsing over down there? And I hope I can go back.
Indeed. As you probably realise, Australia is rather fragmented, very, very large. And getting the press in from Sydney, Melbourne, that proved a little difficult the first time. Now they're already lining up and they want to come in. So I can see television press coverage. It'll be going out, as we hope, on Eurosport and also USA, if we can, Asia. It's amazing where the film turned up from last year. Saudi Arabia, for instance, and so on. So, nothing could look better than the future of the Tour Down Under.
So that's going to give the sport a good boost down there with this race you've got going on. Do you think it'd have an effect on the Australian riders? Because we've seen more and more Aussies coming out. I've never seen so many, but is that going to help the sport there too?
I mean, if the Tour de France were fielding national teams, Australia would have one of the strongest ones.
You're right. Ron Webb from the Tour Down Under, thanks for that. That's good to see you again. And it looks as being down there with the Kangaroos next year. Bye.
So off goes the casino rider Pascal Chantal.
It's Ron Webb gone. Sorry about the bit of a break up there as he disappeared off our conversations, but we did bring that to you on Eurosport, the Tour Down Under last year, and I know that many of you liked it and enjoyed the scenery. I certainly enjoyed the food and the wine and the company and the time to visit a very interesting country. So now back then at the start house, the riders still going 1 minute. So the best time we've had so far then. Well, they've gone back to put up 8.20.11 actually up there. So something seems to have gone amiss, because we thought that we got 7.09. So I think they made a right mess of the timing when Mickelson and Minali got involved in that sprint finish. So sorry about that, dear people back at home, and anybody who's jotting down the times on the back of an old envelope. They've gone back on the time board to put 8.20.11. Our computer's completely crashed down here, so we'll do our best to bring you what we know. Well, still in on the Prologue time trial with the riders out there going around this very interesting course, 6.8 kilometres in all, and we have had at various numbers of times cropped up because we've had a few problems with our computer, and we're sort of home and dry here, and even the board, which flashes above the finish line, seemed to go on the blink, put a 709, now it's gone back to 820. So we've just had one of the riders from Seiko finished, and his time I can tell is 843, because at least I can see that little bit up there. And on the way, the next rider to go, the time exactly here at 18.05. And so we've seen Manuel Beltran of the Binesto team go. And the next one will be Cedric Vasseur. Now, it's an interesting little story for this next chap to come along, Cedric Vasseur. The national championships were held last week. Most of the nations all had their championship on the same day. And the French championships, there was one by Pascal Simon. I forget who was second, but first and second came well away. And I only saw the television when they were picking up a particular story about Mr. Richard Virenque, who was allowed back into the Tour de France when the UCI invoked a certain rule, which was exposed to them by the legal people, and said he has to ride legally, you can't throw him out. So Virenque was riding the national championship of, as we now come back out to Vasseur. Well, what happened, as he came down the finishing line, Virenque, he was clearly in third spot. There was no doubt about it. He just kept riding at reasonable speed. He'd been third, and he'd be on the podium in the French championships. Anyway, Virenque's a bit of a showman. He came down the finishing straight with about 200, 300 metres to go, and starts to take one out of the bar and waves to the crowds and looking at them. He looks over the barriers and waves, you know, like, here I am, you know. And suddenly, woof, this man, Vasseur, came past him, and suddenly the expression on Rock's face, he looked down and he lost the podium place through this waving to the crowd like the royalty blowing kisses to the audience on the side of the road. So Mr. Virenque was fourth and Vasseur was third. Back to Toshnik, we saw him start further on up. Good little climber, this chap, and really brought in some of the team that they brought here. The telecom was originally going to be selected to ride to defend Mr. Ulrich, who won it in 1997, his second place last year. But as you may or may not know, Ulrich smashed his knee and was brought down a crash in Germany, in the Tour of Germany. He cut his head as well. They stitched up his head, but they discovered later on that in fact his knee was worse than they thought, and he got a little blood clot underneath it. They couldn't shift it. So the telecom team now has been, I won't say totally reformed, but they have now got a team that's much more strongly based around Eric Szabo, who's looking for another of the green jerseys in the Tour de France. He's a sprint specialist. We'll probably see him in action tomorrow, looking for that green jersey, and the team will be working hard to defend that jersey for him. So that's the situation then with Ulrich out of the race, that Szabo is now their top brass for the chance of getting some victory for the German team. Beitzenberg we're with now from Rabobank, a very good, useful all-round rider and sprinter specialist too, and he can climb to when it comes to it. So their family Zabergs, Marcus and Bate, but only Bate's been selected to ride for the Rabobank team, and here he is going up this bit of a drag with the crowd urging him on. So there's a time check at the top of that little climb. How far is that climb again, Russell?
4.5 kilometres.
That's the actual, from the start, when he gets there, 4.5. But the actual climb's about, 900 metres, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
And a bit of a steep one, too, to begin with, and levels off after that. So when they get to the top of that, they aren't going to have, the fastest rider that gets there gets the King of the Mountains jersey. So we will have, unusually in a prologue time trial, we will have the King of the Mountains jersey going out to the rider who gets that timed point at the top of that climb, the fastest of them all. So he may not be the sort of man we'll see wearing the polka dot jersey much longer in the race, because we've got some more undulations going through in the early parts of the tour before we hit the big mountains. But I think there's somebody who can go fairly quickly up there. I've got a slight suspicion even Cipollini almost made it in Rouen when we went straight out from the start up the top of the climb. But we'll see what he does later on as we work through the riders going at 1 minute intervals at the start of the prologue here in the Puy de Fou. Well, we're just waiting for Zberg to come in here to see what sort of time he's been doing, and going round the time check so far, he's not actually been featuring on our times. We've got the time now on our computer showing the top five in each of the time checks so far. He hasn't actually featured up there, and the 8.20 is still the time to beat, and that is Brooks' time, 8.20. 8.23 for Gonzalez is second, and as he comes down here, the clock is showing 8.35. He's not going to do it, clock now. We've got everything together by everybody. Yes, Russ?
Now, just to say, one of the favourites should be coming in just after Zeberg is Tom Stills. He's out on the course. He's doing a really fast time. Obviously, he's one of the favourites, obviously, for the green jersey this week.
Well, let's see how he goes through the time check. Let me tell you now, we've got him running, as we're now out back on the course with Vasser, that the times as follows that we have got for you at the two time checks. Pens and paper at the ready? Good. And then Russell will update you for any of the change that happened. Let me take you through what the position is now, and when it changes, Russell will tell you. Backstead was the fastest, by the way, at the 1 kilometre mark. So first time check at 3.7 kilometres. And he was there, the first of time checks, in 4 minutes, 04 seconds. In second spot, Vaserman, the man who just did extremely well in the peace race, came through in 4 minutes, 05. And in third spot, Gonzalez at 4 minutes, 06. Mark Wolters at 4 minutes, 06. And Perron at 4:08. Now, a lot of those chaps came out at the start, like a bat out of hell, and then they, of course, turned and went up this stinking great climb, which just blew a few people away. And when we went over the time there at... just looking up there, 7:49, I think, just went on the board by just watching that. But I think that's wrong. They keep throwing these sevens up. It's totally wrong. It's 8:46:08. That goes on what happened with the time check up there. It's 8:46 for the last rider coming across the line. Verbrugge, then it was, after the second time check at 4 kilometres 50 over the top of the climb. And Verbrugge went through the second check at 5 minutes 38 seconds. He hadn't shown in the first of the five plays. That just shows the ability to climb that little sharp 900 metres, change the whole thing. So the first five were out of contention. Well, not all of them, because Verbrugge took over. Backstead, as he told me, when he turned the corner, he got all the gears wrong and went to a halt. Perron into second spot. So he moved up from fifth before, and his time was 5 minutes and 42 seconds, 4 seconds behind Verbrugge. Van der Velde came through in third spot at 5 minutes and 43 seconds, and in fourth spot was Gonzalez at 5 minutes 44. So there we saw Van der Velde, that we hadn't seen before, popping up onto the leaderboard. And in fifth spot was Vaserman at 5:44. Now, he'd been second fastest at the first time, so he dropped to fifth. Just shows that sharp little climb knocks hell out of the riders when they're going up that climb, and it changes. In fact, Verbrugge then kept the lead right the way through from that to kilometre 4.50 in towards the finish, when we covered 6.80 kilometres, and Verbrugge came through 8 minutes 20.110. Now, we'll have to go very much towards the tenths and hundreds of seconds later on, because that may split the top places. But at the moment, Verbrugge, 8 minutes 20, I'll leave out the 110, we'll go back to later in case that's what splits it, but 8:20 was his time. Time for Gonzalez, 8 minutes 23 seconds. Maignan, 8 minutes 25. Vaserman, 8 minutes 26. And Van der Velde, 8 minutes and 27 was the time after that.
And we just had Tom Stills crossing the line there with an 8:51.
So that's run you down the finishing list as it is at the moment, as the Camerata getting underway at the moment. We'll be getting that's Pasco Rodriguez. It's just gone through the Camerata, and this is the bit all you ladies back home are probably waiting for with bated breath. The man with probably the nicest pair of legs, I suppose. I don't know much about men's legs, but Mr. Cipollini's, Coppilolo is coming up next, and then Salvadelli after that. So the Italian's coming thick and fast, and the next one to go after the Rodriguez from Camer, Coppilolo from Mercadona, then Salvadelli from Psycho, who could get up in the top 10 this year. 8:20:11 to beat. Here comes Vasser then. Certainly the crowd remembering his third spot in the French Championships. Very pleased indeed to cheer on some French. But this is not exactly his cup of tea. It's showing 8:55 right now for Vasser, so he's not going to be really in contention then. Verbrugge's time still 8:20:11 to beat. In fact, he's going to be outside 9 minutes. But he's the man who took a long break in the Tour de France the other year, and not only did he win the stage, but he took the yellow jersey as well. So those are the sort of riders that are in the Crédit Agricole team that we could see imagine later on.
Le Château du Puyou.
Well, the Chateau de Puy-de-Fou in the background. Those on the left-hand side, you saw that enormous great grandstand. Well, that was absolutely packed last night. They brought the teams through, three teams at a time, with all the actors of the various show that was going to happen later on. There were like 800 people take part in the big show, and they reenact old battles, they reenact history. In this part of the world, they've had more than their fair share of problems over the years, and it's a tremendous sight. And if you come across here on these package tours, they'll always get you tickets to go to see the show, and many people come out and go down and see the show in the evening. They've got a nice balmy evening like last night with the warm temperature. In fact, as we drove back from the presentation last night, the temperature on little indicator on my Fiat Ulysses van was exactly 20 degrees. That was late last night, showing 20 degrees. In fact, yesterday the temperatures were touching around about 35. Not quite so hot today. Somewhat better conditions for the riders as they go around this course. 6.8 kilometres is the distance for the Prologue time trial. If you've just joined us, I'm David Duffield. Russell Williams sitting alongside me in the commentary box, and we're waiting for the top men to come later on. The Chris Borman, with bated breath, will be waiting to set out around this course. It could be very suitable for him, although that short, sharp climb is not normally to his liking. All the rest of the course, I think, will be exactly what he wants. Chris, this year, if you want to make little notes about his performance since he's been riding in the Prologue time trials this year, or short distance time trials, as our camera here is picking up Sabadelli from the Psycho team, a man who did some tremendous rides in the Tour of Italy this year, and he's fairly going to be tipped as one of those riders I think we're going to have in the future to watch out for. There's so many changes going on in the cycling field at the moment, with new riders coming through, and that Sabadelli is one of them. He finished Sabadelli in second spot in the Tour of Italy, and he was really, I think, always there or thereabouts, particularly after stage 14, when Sabadelli won that stage. He beat Pantani on that day. The two of them got away on the climb, with Clivero coming up into third spot, and that began to move it straight up onto the rostrum. And Sabadelli also not a bad time trialist. When we went to the second time trial stage 18, Gonchar was the winner, but Sabadelli finished in second spot. But that was over some 45 kilometres, so it's very different indeed to be riding around a short, sharp one like this. So Sabadelli could be quite a respectable time, and really anybody's going to look for a place on the podium in Paris in 3 weeks' time, they've got to be up there in maybe the top for 20 spots, although some of the mountain climbers might still be able to turn things upside down on their head. Not all that easy this year, because the course isn't as hilly as some of the people would like. So Guarini underway. I said that the telecom team had to be reformed to extent when Ulrich dropped out, but they've got this man Guarini here, who that's why they kept some of the climbers in the team rather than set it all up around Zabel, because he has been in the Tour of Italy. He finished twice third in the Tour of Italy, as we look back again at the delightful Chateau and come back up to Sabadelli. Looking again then at the board now, at the finishing line, still Verbrugge, 8.20 is the best time. Gonzalez in second spot, 8.23. Maynon still there, 8.25 in third. Vaseman in fourth spot still at 8.26. And Van der Velde at 8.27. Van der Velde, is that the son of the old track rider, Russ?
Yeah, his father used to be a track rider. Also, I think he actually owns a track on the East Coast. But just looking at Salvadelli, I'm sure that he won the national road race at the weekend. He wouldn't be wearing the jersey now because it's in a Prologue time trial. But I know one of the Psycho riders actually did win the Italian Road Championships. Maybe I can look into that.
I could tell you, Russell, but my great big briefcase, which you laughingly call my computer, I rushed out this morning from the hotel and left it there. So that's terrible. I'm doing this all off the seat of my pants. Thank goodness I've got a big seat. We just had a quick look at him going up the climb, and he certainly is giving it some stick, the man who finished second in the Tour of Italy, so we might get a quick time off him to try and dislodge Verbrugge's time of 8.20, which is the best one we've got so far. Gonzalez still in second spot at 8.23, and Maignan at 8.25 into third spot. That's the position out there on the course, as Brochard coming around here, the ex-world champion from the race in San Sebastian. Another man had to serve a bit of suspended sentence for the things that happened last year, and there he goes round the course in his new guys, the new Festina colours of blue and yellow, and back then with Salvador. Yes, Russ?
Yeah, I've just looked in the books. Actually, it was Camesso who actually won the National Road Championships, but he does ride for Psycho.
And
but obviously the whole team has been working, especially the first week, for Mario Cipollini, as we see him up this climb here. It's in the small ring.
Yes, that is one of the problems with teams that have like two strings to play. When they're going out in the flat stars, they've got a part to go to work for Cipollini, who doesn't usually go much past the Alps if we're going around the way we're going around this time. Yes, Russ.
Yeah, we've got Martin Dembacker here just straightening his glasses, a former Dutch champion, ready for his 6.8 kilometres of pain.
Still Dutch champion.
Still the champion, sorry.
Is the champion.
Is the champion.
Right, Dembacker. I had a chat to Dembacker, actually, and congratulated him on his red, white and blue blands that he got round his jersey. And he said, yeah, we kept it in the team because last year it was Bogart that was the Dutch champion, so they've got the same jersey. I suppose, I don't know if he's the same size or just a washerman can of the next sort of chap. But what is that whole new set made? I didn't get around to asking that. I think he's a bit bigger than Bogart. But I asked him because Dembacker and the lads were racing in the Tour de Suisse, and we watched them there, seeming to go on the, I won't say 100% all the way around, but I was very interested in his observation about Pavel Tonkov, who we saw on a couple of occasions try to get away on the mountain and didn't quite make it. And I said, you know, was he just sort of playing? And he was very, very fit. He said, no, he's not at full form. He said, yeah, they could tell in the Tour de Suisse, he was just trying himself, he was pushing himself hard to see how far he could go before he blew. And he felt he's just coming into form, Pavel Tonkov, exactly the right time through the Tour de Suisse, so he can go into this race, because we've got, you know, 10 days or so of fairly flat, or 9 days of fairly flat condition, then bang into the mountainside.
But you say he was playing on one of those particular stages. I remember that mountainous stage. Was it the last 20 kilometres uphill where he actually attacked near the bottom and he got caught, was it 2 kilometres from the finish?
Yeah, very, very exciting. There we are, back then out with Sabadelli. And we're peering in through to see if there's been any change here at the moment. The first three are still the same, and still the times at the at those. No, they're all. So I rather think this thing might not be working, Russell, because I can't think they've all been the same ever since then. So 8:20 still to beat, and Sabadelli might be the man to do it. But the time checks we haven't had so far making any change. Well, back then to the start house. Nardello underway. Now there is Nardello underway through, and he'll be followed after that by Stuart O'Grady, and this is the one, sorry, by the, David Navas of the Benesto team, then Stuart O'Grady will be next to come. Well, Sabadelli coming up now, the time is showing, for some reason it's frozen, it's showing 9:17, that's the other man, no, 8:28, this is Sabadelli, no, he's only on 8:30 to 8:30. Oh, they've now put 8:17.95 up. So, well, if that holds, then that's the new time we've got. But it does seem, and I've gone back to 8:33.57. I just can't comprehend this machine we've got up there in the sky called a time clock. 8:20.11 is still shown, and 8:33.57 seems to be the time for Sabadelli. We'll have to see if that one. Yes, Russ?
Yeah, just going back to our leader, Rick Van Bruggen from the Lotto team. I mean, didn't we notice just yesterday they've actually changed bikes just for the Tour de France? They've gone to a GT model.
Yes, they have, and I went down into the pits and had a look at them earlier on. And interesting enough, we're going to get to see various different sorts of bikes. Here we've got one of the standard Colnago-type bicycles being used here by Dembacker. And we also looked yesterday at a very aerofoil-type bicycle that the Rabobank boys are going to be using. And the same thing with GT. They've made a whole lot of new bicycles. They came in, took over the sponsorship of the team with regards to bicycles at very, I say, short notice. They made the arrangement with the previous supplier. And they were rather interesting. We'll look at them later on. Here we are then. Stuart O'Grady, the man who's been a world track champion, and now on the road, a man who took the yellow jersey in the Tour de France last year, and a winner of the Pro Tour of Great Britain, and then went on to win the early part of this year, the Tour Down Under in Adelaide. He comes from Adelaide. He's got a vast support of many of the Australians. They come over here, the press and people from the Tour Down Under, to watch this man. And, of course, his parents are here. Let's see how Stuart goes. This could be right up Stuart O'Grady's creek, because he is an extremely good track man, a very good pursuiter, a very good sprinter, and a very gutsy rider indeed. He did look a bit tired early on in the season. The Amstel Gold certainly was going round, really, his eyes were like the proverbials in the snow, but he's now recovered, I think, his form, and we'll wait to see what he has to do this time. Well, Guarini coming up here, 8:21.1 to beat, and this man, a good, useful climber, and he'll be able to go over the hilly bits quite well, but the clock is running at 8:34, 8:35, so it doesn't look like he's going to do it again. He's giving all he's got, but this course is cutting a few people out, I think. That hill's not doing him any good, and the fast men are drying on the way out toward, on the, up the turn, at the time, at the turn and up the climb, whereas the... we're back out. This is Pascal Simon, by the way, the champion of France, riding for the Crédit Agricole team. He's wearing the red, white and blue colours, or blue, white and red colours that were previously on the back of Laurent Jalabert, who's not riding in this race. I did say earlier on that the Jalabert, who we had seen on the list of starters that Mario Sainz had put forward, in fact he put forward some 12 names and didn't say which of them was going to be a reserve, then he cut it down to 9 names and kept Jalabert's name on the list. I saw one published in the press room. I thought this can't be so, because Jalabert didn't seem to be interested, and of course it kept everybody napping, a bit of one-upmanship I suppose on Sainz's part, and then in the end Jalabert wasn't going to ride. So the French championship, he didn't ride that either, did Jalabert. So Simon in the blue, white and red, the French champion, will be representing the colours, the tricolour colours of France. Back out there on the road with Stuart O'Grady.
I also thought the interesting thing was last night, the presentation, they actually had him on the far left-hand side, and he's actually got a number one that actually makes him team captain over Boardman.
Yes, well, you see... I don't mean to be disrespectful to Chris, and I think you've been talking to his team manager, I mean, following up certain things with him, that he only once has been all the way round, and he's recognised now he's not a three-week racer, and I see not a lot wrong in some people saying, right, I'm not going to be the team leader, because when you've got a team leader, in fact this is 136, I mean Simon was the team leader, of course he's been the French champion as well, but when you put a man in, they all have to work for the team leader, and as far as Bourbon's concerned, once he gets the time trials underway, he'll be working for different riders and himself. He's not going to get into the top three on the podium, or maybe not make the top 10, or not even make it to Paris. So he doesn't get the accolade of team leader on this sort of race. He will on the shorter one. He's very good at between 5 and 10 day stage races when he can last the distance. But don't forget, he came into this sport late, as we're watching riders go around here. Chris didn't turn pro until he was 26 years of age, and he'd be 34 this August when he turns 34 in August, and there aren't a lot of riders still keep going on at that level. And now Brochard coming up here, the French are getting rather excited indeed. 8:20 to beat, but he's now 8:10, 8:11, 8:12. Brochard, if that clock is right, is really storming up here, and he's showing 8:16 still, and Brochard burying himself along here, and the time clock of the Festina rider is just going to show he's gone over 8:27, I think it is, yeah, 8:27. They show 8:23. Somehow this clock does flick, but 8:23.77. Now, I shall not take the first time they put up, but 8:23.37 it was. Only 3 seconds, so he must move up into second spot if our computer is working. I think somehow this thing is not working. We've had no intermediate time check that changed since we've been on air for the last 5 minutes. I don't know if you can sort that with somebody, but how do we get this thing to work?
Someone did tell me it changed every 3 minutes. But back to Brochard, I mean, that was an excellent ride, considering he had the suspension of 6 months and didn't come back to race until the beginning of May.
Go and look at their computer to see if it's working. Well, there we are, still out with Stuart O'Grady on this course, and I was mentioning earlier about Chris Bourbon. Now he'd be out there in the start house warming up. We've had the cameras go around there where the riders sit on the rollers on a spare bike and ride and ride. They take their pulse meter up to the level which they want, and they're working away to get themselves all sweaty and ready, and they come to the start line almost heaving and heaving with breath, and they off they go. And of course Chris Bourbon is an absolute specialist at this sort of distance, although this hill might cause him some troubles, like it seems to be stretching Stuart O'Grady now.
Yeah, just looking at Stuart, he's got a brand new Porsche, I believe, just like you used to have. But talking about sporty cars, Chris Bourbon's got a new car, new Lotus, customised, an orange Elise.
That's it, good for him. I like that, it's not a bad little car. Now, you're looking at a bike which will be on the scrap heap next year. This Pinarello bicycle is no longer available ridden as for the year 2000. Mr. Verbruggen and the UCI have said that the single monotube down tube bicycles cannot now be allowed. Well, Brochard, we've now got certainly on our board here. He's into third spot. Verbruggen still leads. Gonzalez is second, and Brochard is in third with his 8:25, sorry. Back out on the course with Jean-Cyril Robin of the La Française des Jeux team, and he going around here, as you see by his number 151, is the team captain of La Française des Jeux. And he's been quite a useful competitor in the Tour de France in recent years. And at one time, the French thought he could make his way to the podium. Perhaps he might this year come of age. We've got such an open Tour de France that many people said, oh, gosh, it won't have the same sort of appeal. Let's go now back into the start house at the moment with Ludo Dirksen of the Lamprey team. He's wearing the national colours, as champion of Belgium, took it over off Tom Steels. And I'm very pleased, actually, with this chap Dirksen. And I know that some of you people listen to Eurosport's coverage of cycling almost wall-to-wall year, you know, year in, year out. And something I say, I repeat myself, but I have in this tour to make many simple observations and talk about things which you will probably know about, because we get lots of new viewers for the Tour de France, much more than we do for any other programme. And this man Dirksen, he had an interesting background. He's getting on a bit now, but he, in fact, was a car sprayer. He worked in the DAF factory spraying vehicles, and he was part-time cyclist. He'd ride the Kermesses and the Criteriums, and then he went to ride for Lotto, still sort of keeping up the day job and going from time to time to work in the factory. And then bit by bit he got himself even better established, and he rode so well last year he picked up a darn good contract with the Lamprey team, and now he's riding, and now he's the national champion of Belgium. And good luck to him too. A very strong rider, and we'll see him in action on the, I'm sure he'll be looking for a stage victory for himself and for his team. So, Stuart O'Grady coming through now. The time we've got to beat is 8:20:11. 8:58. Just come up with the ball for the last rider to go across the line as O'Grady starts to come in here. And the time has not started to run for O'Grady. 8:18, he's at 8:19, so he's not going to get this. As 8:21 comes up on the screen, and O'Grady's counting back through. And now, well, that just shows you that superb ride we've got so far, as he's now crossed the line, O'Grady, and in 8:28:20. Sorry, back out in the start house, the start area. The last few riders now getting ready and warming up for the race ahead of them. We've got the top men, Bourbon, Armstrong. In fact, let's go through from the last rundown of the last top men as we go out back out with Jean-Cyril Aubin. Escartin is followed by Cancelli, then Cipollini, then Jackie Duran, then Eric Zabel, then Richard Veronque, Angel Casero, Christophe Moreau, Michael Bogard, Alexander Vinokourov, Pavel Tsongkhov, Alex Zulup, Chris Bourbon, Lance Armstrong, Abra Milano, and Bobby Julich. And that's the run coming through. And running down those names, it will make some of you who know a bit about cycling say, hey, it's going to be still a race that's interesting. The trouble is, the minute that Pantani and Ulrich said they couldn't ride, a lot of people sort of wrote the tour off and said, oh, well, it's, you know, it's lost its power and its interest. It has not, because Alano, who's riding, he won the Tour of Spain in 1998. He's been third in the Giro d'Italia in 96. He's the world road champion and world time trial champion. Alex Zulla, who's won the Tour of Spain twice as well, and second the Tour de France in 1995. Tsongkhov, he's ridden the Tour of Italy six times, and five times he's finished up in the top five. He's won it once and he's second twice as well. Gotti from the Cyco team has twice been winner of the Tour of Italy. Guarini, we've seen him already. He's been twice third in Giro d'Italia. Escartin, twice second in the Tour of Spain. And Lance Armstrong, who finished fourth last year in the Tour of Spain. Bobby Julich, third last year in the Tour de France. Michael Bogart, fifth last year in the Tour de France. So we've got a lot of talent and some young chaps pushing through. This is going to be a very, very interesting tour. We're bringing it live on Eurosport every day. We're picking up the German champion Udo Bölts from the telecom team. I said this field this year is full of a lot of talent, and this man here, I think very rightfully the German champion this year, and that will keep the jersey in the telecom team, as we had the same thing happen with the Rabobank team too as well. As he gets underway now, Bölts off on this Prologue time trial, 6.8 kilometres.
Yeah, Dad, I'm just wondering, because of the fact that Jan Ulrich is out now, do you think the whole team would just be working for the sprinter?
No. As I mentioned earlier on, the Guarini, you see, having been twice third in the Tour of Italy, I think could certainly climb, these climbs aren't that bad and could do quite well. So they've got one or two like Toshnik round about Guarini, hoping to get a place up in the top three. As you see confirmation on your screen of the position now with Brochard there in third spot. And they will ride earlier on. I think with two or three of the mountain climbers will probably sit at the back. But you watch that telecom string when we start going down on the stage victory. We see exactly the same. They're so well drilled for setting things up for Zabel to get the stage victories. We're here then with Gonzalez Galdiano of the Vitero Siligura Euros team. Next after him will be Vladimir Belli of Festina, then Eric Decker of Rabobank, and Stephen Barth of the Casino team. Then the great Axel Merckx will be here, the great one, because I saw his father out in the pit area a bit further back, and he looks a bit rotund now. He's had probably too many fritz and beers at the old Eddie Merckx. Going on the Eddie Merckx, just mentioning his name, by the way, this, the first prologue, there are often people say to me, with the prologue, why isn't there a prologue in the Tour of Italy? And if you look down the list of the stage races, very few of them, there are probably fewer have the prologues than do have prologues. There are more that don't than do. And it's never been part of the Tour of Italy's stance. I'll have to go back to Tour of Italy. I think I found about two occasions when they'd had a prologue. We'll have to go back and look at it more closely. But whoever it was who wrote to me on that basis, it's not been part of the thing. But the Tour de France didn't have their first prologue until 1967. They didn't have them before that. And they've had them all the years through then, except on two occasions they've had team time trials as the prologue, a shorter team time trial. And the first prologue they ever held was in a place called Angers, and that was in 1967. And mentioning Eddie Merckx, in 1972, when the Tour started again in Angers, they also had a prologue time trial there. So it went on all the way through, right from 1967 until now, with just a couple of team time trials in the midst of it as a prologue to open up. Yes, Russ?
Yes, we're looking at Gotti. I remember, was it last year they used to have McDonald's, the hamburger chain, on their...
Yeah, they just came for the Tour de France, yeah. Some of the jurors changed the Tour de France, so we're responsible to come in just for the publicity, and we'll put some money in. Subject, of course, to the rest of the team sponsors allowing it to come in, and that's exactly what they do to get some extra publicity.
As Robin comes in, last year he was with US Postal Service.
Yep, he's a bit off the pace again now, so I don't think he's going to be too happy with that one. But so as Robin finishes, the time 8:49.33, so he's a good 29 seconds adrift then on that particular part. I mentioned in Angers, and those of you perhaps being catching up with the ins and outs of Tour de France, the way that Peronc has been put back in legally by the UCI, and then the problem with Mr. Size, who's been told that he can come here by the UCI. And as I drove down here along the motorways, watching Dixon come in here to the finish, I went past a big sign at Angers, where I just mentioned we had the first ever prologue time trial in the Tour de France, and his time, by the way, this fellow's come in about 8:33. So at Angers, where they had the first prologue time trial, not far from me, and I came through it two days ago, and they've got a tapestry in there, and as you drive along, it's got this big sign for about this tapestry, and I thought, how appropriate, and I hope things don't go this way, but it's a tapestry of the apocalypse, and oh dear, so that's the apocalypse, which it was commissioned way back in 1370, and woven in atmosphere of grandeur and silence over a 10-year period, by the way. And after it came out of the church, it just ended up neglected and scattered and all over the place, and they've been piecing it back together again, and now 5 centuries on, the work has been rightfully restored to its place in the Chateau of Angers. So I thought, oh, the tapestry of the apocalypse. It's an enormous thing, about 130 metres long, and it's also the tapestry is on both sides, which is most unusual. Those who follow tapestry, you usually have it just facing one side. This, how the heck they did, I don't know, but it's a double-sided tapestry. Yeah, I'll just say, like, now, the apocalypse. Let's hope we don't have it in the Tour de France this year. Back out then on the course
with Ivan Gotti.
And back out into the start house then, as we're getting on towards the real fast men coming up here. And this fellow here, Stephen Barth, is a past French champion, road champion. But Casino, somebody's asking me as to whether they thought the Casino team might do well this year in the Tour with Vinokourov, because he's a young rider. He's going to be the man that goes off, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 from the back, Vinokourov, who's only 21 years of age. But I felt that the Casino team is full of individuals. They don't work the same sort of way that we might find the US Postal team, for instance, riding for Armstrong. Well, we keep jumping around backwards and forwards and out on the road then, and still that fastest time we've got to beat of Verbrugge is at 8 minutes 20 and 11. Yes, Russ?
And we've got Laurent Dufault out there, number 74. He's another one who's just come back from suspension, 6 months out.
Well, here he is coming on in, and our computer seems to have crashed down again. Would you like to press the buttons, Russ? Well, the time to beat then still 8:20, but he's not going to get it. The clock is showing something like 8:50 odd. Oh, in fact, no, that was just the Merckx Tanuno rise come across our line. Going back to Axel Merckx, the big rider from Mapei Quickstep. Now, Mapei again have built the team entirely round about Pavel Tonkov.
Yeah, I was just going to I just noticed on Axel Merckx, he's got the new moustache and beard there, very trendy. But as you say, the whole team is actually built around Tonkov.
And here, Dufault then, 8:20.11 is the one that they've got to beat. And coming up the finishing straight, he's getting out the saddle fast as he can do, Dufault. But I think perhaps that little bit of absence from the edge of racing will have sapped his speed. And there we are, 8:25 and 48 kilometres an hour at his time. So that's just around about 30 miles an hour, which you, with this course, with that big climb in it, is not that bad at all. Quite quick, in fact. 8:20 still to beat, and 8:20 for Brugge is the time to beat.
You've talked about Dufault having 6 months off and, you know, he's not coming back too sharp. But what about Casagrande in the Tour of Italy? In the Tour of Switzerland.
Yeah, well, of course, he's not riding this one, is he? Because his team's been slung out. I mean, he did a good ride after he came back, but as we were saying, when Tony Rango was telling us earlier on, the Casagrande sort of rider, even when he was racing, if he was just in an off-season, he was still training, and if he had a bit of a break, he still came back, you know, absolutely race fit. And so he'd been able to race all the way through, and Casagrande came back with a bang, but he couldn't ride because of the trouble with Gonchar. Those you may not know, Gonchar in the Tour of Switzerland, in the time trial stage, he was riding extremely well. He won the time trial stage in the Tour of Italy as well, and he got a blood test, and they found out that he was in fact over the 50%, and it was 2 weeks, and he couldn't actually get to ride in the Tour de France, although he would have come off his blood test on Thursday. He would have had 15 days, but they couldn't take the risk of him not getting back into full fitness. It's a health check that they do, and so he wasn't allowed to ride. His team was taken out, and Casagrande went with it too. So Simon from the French squad there, sorry, the French champion, riding for Crédit Agricole. They must be rather pleased with that, the Crédit Agricole, a very nice French bank that came into sponsorship in August last year after Tour de France, stepped in to take over the GAN team sponsor. We've never seen that before, have we, Red Ruskin? Somebody changed a complete team in the midst of a season.
No, it's usually done right at, you know, I mean, obviously, there's a lot of, you know, talking goes on during the Tour de France with the riders about teams for next year, but most of the teams actually do swap over in the wintertime. There's a lot of pressure on this guy, you know, the new French champion. And as you say, it's a strong team, but they haven't got any big winners, any big climbers either in the team.
Well, the effort and the agony showing on the face of Udo Boltz, and that time still for Verbrugge, 8:20.11, still standing up there, and the top men yet to come. Just let's go down last year's time trial in Dublin, in case you want to look out for some of the... We saw Dufault just finish. He only finished in eighth spot last year he finished in eighth spot in Dublin, but didn't do quite as well this year. And Bourbon it was that won the time trial last year in Dublin, the Prologue time trial. Short, sharp, the point it was, 5.6 kilometres, were not much of a climb in it at all. It dragged a bit in one place, and he rocketed round there, Chris did, in 6 minutes and 12 seconds. He averaged 54.193 kilometres an hour. So you can see the times we've got here are only just around about the 50 kilometres an hour mark, how much faster Bourbon went on a shorter course in Dublin last year. So he won the time trial, the Prologue time trial last year in Dublin, did Chris Bourbon. Alano was in second spot at 4 seconds, and Alano is riding, and in fact Alano will be going up last but one. The man who finished third, Jalabert, is not riding this year. The man who finished in fourth spot last year, Julich, is riding. Bobby Julich is the last man to go. He was 5 seconds adrift of Chris Bourbon. Morrow, also riding this year. He was 5 seconds adrift in fifth spot. Ulrich, not racing this year, was sixth. Zuller, racing this year, was seventh. Dufault, eighth. Chamil, ninth. And Yekimov, tenth. So we've got a bit of a benchmark. And now you can see Gotti coming through here. The winner of the Tour of Italy this year hasn't got out of his legs either. They're in 8:49. Wouldn't expect much more. When we get in the mountains, we'll see a different style as well, as a big Axel Merckx here with a bit of seat pin sticking up out of the, or seat tube out of the frame with a pin. A very long-legged gangling character, much taller than his dad. It usually happens in this day and age when people grow taller than their parents. This is it. Now, watch out, Axel. Take a deep breath. Whoa, there you are, Russ. That's the one you saw. What do you think?
He handled it really well, but actually did a good ride last year. He was 10th overall last year, so it should be interesting to see how he does this year. The crowd's really behind him. It's really starting to hurt now. He's starting to slow down.
Got the gear wrong, do you see that?
Yeah.
Now, what Magnus backstage saying was telling Hengfeld how to come round that corner. And I think the thing, if you get the gear what may be a bit low at the bottom, you try and blast up it on one. In fact, Chris Bormann's only riding with a single ring on the front. He's not got a double chain ring, and he's riding with this Mavic Mechtronic system, so he's got the buttons at the end of his triathlon bars, and he can change gears on the front of the triathlon bars, and also there are buttons on the brake where he can change gear as well. So once Chris gets down, then he's only got a single ring. Most other riders I've looked at have got a double chain ring, either because they aren't that bothered. I mean, Chris has just absolutely dedicated this. Well, Renault underway, last year taking the King of the Mountains jersey and finishing, well, I think it's fourth spot last year in the Tour de France. Hasn't fired on all cylinders so far this season. Maximoch choosing to ride on the hooks at the top there to try and get some oxygen down inside his lungs on this climb. It certainly is sapping the strength of these big blokes. The big blokes go very quickly on the flatter part to begin with, and they swing round up this climb, this 900 metres of climbing. The first bit is the agony stretch. It's only about 100 metres, 120 metres long, and then after that, it drags on right toward the top where the King of the Mountain of the World will go to the fastest man at that spot. Teddy Buchanan next to go. I've given the rundown on the Dublin results, as it was last year, and Chris Bormann then looking to get the hat trick, because he did get to, I'm sorry if I keep referring to Chris, but I know many people will be right behind him, and if you all get there psychologically tuned when he comes on to the start line, he'll be coming through. If you just come in from what we've been doing this afternoon, he's going off at 7:06 Central European time. That's 6:06 for those you're watching in Britain, either on Eurosport European service or on the digital service of Eurosport. That'll be 6:06 back in Great Britain for Chris Bormann, and he'll be the last but three to go. Well, Axel Merckx on his way around. He's happy to get over the top of that climb. And we're getting down towards the back end of the selections now. Bo Hamburger here, past stage winner in the Tour of France, ready to go. And in fact, we're now on to all the last of these last 20 riders are just one for each team. The 20 teams taking part with 9 riders in all, that makes 180 riders. And what they do, they've been seeding them so that each of the teams have their best man towards the back end. So what we're seeing now is the best man in each team coming through. We've gone through, Bourguignon was the final selection for Big Matt Aubert, and Bo Hamburger now for Contina Tolle is out there on the course. And so we'll work our way down the riders that are going to be in with a shout for a place on the podium or up in the top 20 when we get to the Champs-Élysées in 3 weeks' time. Imagine that, 3 weeks of racing this year, 20 stages we've had. We've had going two, plus the prologue we're seeing now, and we're having 2 rest days, which we've not had, not since I've been involved with the race, 2 rest days, but it's trying to take the pressure off the riders. Stefan Hulot, past man who's been champion of France and taken the yellow jersey in the Tour de France to go then for the Française des Jeux. The order still then for Brugger, Gonzalez, Brochard, first, second and third. Can any of these later starters do anything about it? Hulot setting out with his car going in behind him. The team manager in each case, the team and deputy team managers, with this final lot going through, you'll find that the main team manager will be going round with the last man, keeping an eye on him. The spare bike's at the back in case he has any problems, the mechanic in the back seat as well, and back out with Lance Armstrong. I was going to hope we were going to see him looking remarkably relaxed, isn't he? He'd been warming up down the rollers. Lance Armstrong fought back from cancer and now is one of the top stars of this race, a man that many of, everywhere I go around and we talk and we say who could win the day, who can win this, well, who can win the Tour, and the time that Armstrong's name's come up, Russ, you must have had it, eh?
Yeah, it's been absolutely, it's just breathtaking really when you think about it. I mean, the fact that, you know, he was on
well, back then to the best rider from the Lamprey team, Serpellin, the one they're hitting the most chances, they hope to get up there in the finishing rostrum, but I don't think this course is entirely to his liking. and the Italians, many of them, I won't say they're burnt out, but they've been riding in the Tour of Italy. That's their number one tour, and so we don't always get the great oomph from the Italian teams to come into the Tour de France. There have been Italian victors over the years in the Tour de France, but in reality, they want to get the Tour of Italy on their belts, and not many people can ride the two back-to-back and win both. Stephen Roche, who will be joining us perhaps later on, did just that, and if I go back down the list, well, of course, Pantani won it last year by sheer hill climbing. He does not ride in this year. We now look at Nesgarten, another superb hill climber, or mountain climber, and I think he could be in a shout for a stage, maybe something like the Alpe d'Huez, particularly if the people like Armstrong, who are not gifted mountain climbers, are watching each other. Here, say, Bogart and Tonkov and Armstrong are all watching each other. Something like this fellow who can just release himself and go, then we might well see that Escarting getting a stage victory. He was riding, I think, either third or fourth in the Tour de France last year when the Spanish teams all walked out of the Tour, much encouraged by Mr. Manuel Sainz, hence the reason the Tour de France didn't want him to ride this year, to manage this year. But nevertheless, when the Spanish teams walked out, then Escarting lost that chance of his being up there in on the finish rostrum. There are a round of applause for Simon. He finished. He has not moved up into the top three place at all. Still, Verbrugge is leading. Gonzalez second. Bronchard in third place as we watch the French champion cross the line. Back out then to the rider here, Stefano Garzelli, winner of the Tour of Switzerland last year, and quite a useful little mountain climber. With Pantani not riding now, then he will be in with a chance to get the full support from the Mercato Nuno team. Pantani said right back in November last year, in fact it was on November the 5th that Pantani said he was not going to ride the Tour de France this year. Well, the fireworks were a bit late arriving for the Tour de France, because they said then in the launch on November the 5th they would ban certain individuals they felt would bring the Tour de France into disrepute, and they tried to stop Ferrand from riding, they tried to stop Sainz from coming, but in the end the UCI dominated, and we have those people with us in the race this year. Now we've Mario Cipollini up on the start house, this man who has a very good chance of taking the yellow jersey if he does a good time trial today, and when he gets the bonuses in the sprints tomorrow. This man's all muscle and all verve, eh?
He's all muscle, but he's also had 12 wins this year, and I think at the beginning of the season he was down in, I think it was Namibia, for altitude training.
Well, here's an Italian who'll do well batting for the green jersey and the stage victories. I say, last year we had Pantani a runner victor, and going back, the previous Italian victory before that, I'm going an awful long way back, it was Gimondi, who I saw in the press tent today. 1965 was the last time here that an Italian before Pantani won the Tour of France, because they put all effort into Tour of Italy. But this man will do well. He knows full well he can go to the Alps and then go home, eh?
Well, that's it. But also, he's saying he wants to go to the Olympics next year. Might ride the pursuit this year at the World Championships in Berlin. But also, he's really got to ride really hard today in the Prologue, because obviously he's another one who wants to get the yellow jersey in the first week.
Well, certainly last year's Etzebrugge coming in here, no threat again to Verbrugge on the top. We knew that Cipollini did a good ride last year, and the doubling one was more to his liking, pretty short. And I think that's why he decided to try and go and ride the pursuit, the World Championship in Berlin this year. It's the back end of the year in October, and he feels that he will be okay. Ross, you're mainly a track man, and I mean, world masters champion on the track as well. What's your attitude towards the switch from the track to the road and back again? Because some riders seem to do it and some don't. I always recommend you should ride the track to sharpen your speed if you're a road rider.
Well, definitely, yeah. The thing is, I mean, there's been a lot of the top road riders, I mean, especially like we're looking at probably Tom Steele's here, and I'm just trying to think of a few others. Stuart O'Grady was a former track rider. And the thing is, you know, if you start the track when you're young, it helps with your pedaling. And also a lot of the top track riders, I mean, like our own Rob Hales from, you know, Great Britain, he's a track rider. But as you say, you know, he won a stage of the Pro Tour.
Well, I think it's always good to go a bit on track. I used to wander around myself some years gone by. I think it also teaches you a bit of bike handling, which is jolly useful when you're in a big bunch, and particularly if you're coming in towards a sprint finish. Now, there come Rinero. Went on to make a tremendous ride, won the Tour de l'Avenir last year for Cofidis, having done well in the Tour de France. He just said he could do back-to-back two major tours. So I think that he just hurt himself too much and blew himself up. And my goodness, Russ, once you sort of go into a bad patch, you go into a bad patch, don't you, eh?
Oh, you definitely do. But look at the Rinero. But obviously, the whole Tour de France, what he's got to do is actually work for Bobby Urich. And as you say there, Eric Zabel, twice winner Milan-San Remo, and obviously going for the green jersey.
Well, that again is something he would like to get again, yet that green jersey over his shoulders as Zabel goes. And now here comes the man. There's going to be a wave of roars of approval for this man going round as Veronique then comes to the line, concentrating on this Prologue time trial from the Puy de Fuy, the 1999 Tour de France, setting off in fine style. Last night when Richard Veronque was presented to the crowd, an enormous, massive crowd in the Puy de Fou, they all stood up, they cheered, they pointed, they were very pleased to see him back in the race, but that is not the opinion everybody holds, but that's the law. He's back in because they found the loophole in the regulations after the Tour de France said he couldn't ride. The UCI said, yes, he must ride. So here he is now, and there he goes round the corner. Listen to this. This man has got an enormous following in France, all the way around the course. In fact, I can see from my commentary point now, there's a cardboard sign just across the way there. It's about 20 inches by 30 inches. It's got the tricolour, the blue, white and red colour of the French flag on it. It's got LA in green in little letters, then Richard in the blue, RIC, HA in white, and RD in the red. So red, white and blue, LA Richard, they've come in with their banners to support the Frenchman on the way around. Yes, Russ.
Yeah, still looking at the overall classman is Rick Van Bruggen from Lotto, the 24-year-old, with a 9.20. Second is Gonzalez, and third is Brochard.
8.20.
8.20, pardon.
Your eyes are worse than mine, and you're younger than me. Right then, and interesting enough too that the times we've been having at the first, second time checks have not changed either since we've been looking at it. In fact, O'Grady was fifth now. It takes a bit of time for it to come through. Say about 3 minutes. Well, O'Grady was fifth at the first time check. Again, let me run through them as the riders going to get underway. We've got Casero here going through, the Spanish champion again. That's twice he's been champion. By the way, Casero, I'll go back to time in just a moment. Casero, this year in the prologue in the Tour of Catalonia, which is running the same time as the Tour of Switzerland, Casero in an 8.1 kilometer prologue time trial, he was first and he beat Alano by 3 seconds. So he shouldn't discount Casero, particularly now he's wearing the national champion's jersey. Next to go, by the way, will be Christoph Murrow. Murrow last year finishing fifth in the time trial in Dublin. Very great time trials here too as well, and he will be the next to go after we just saw Casero get underway, and then we'll be Bogart back out the road then with Richard Veronque. And just a reminder of those times at the first time check after 3.7 kilometres as Christoph Moreau gets ready. Still at the first time check, Backstead was 4 minutes 04, Vaseman 4.05, Gonzalez 4.06, Wouters 4.06, and O'Grady at 4.06. So a lot of those chaps started fast and faded from the scene because Verbrugge, by the time he got the second time check at 4 minutes and 50 seconds, was in the lead then with 5 minutes and 38. Brochard jumped up into second spot, having not been there in the top five to begin with, at 5 minutes 41. And Perron was third at 5.42. Van der Velde fourth and Dufault fifth. By the time he got to the finish, Verbrugge still storming in to the finish, came through to set the fastest time. 8 minutes 20 seconds. Gonzalez still second, 8.23. Brochard, 8.23, also there in third spot. Back out with some of the top men, and this is where it could all change. Michael Bogart here for Rabobank. What a disappointment it was last year when he punctured in the World Championships when he was probably with a shout to try and get a medal. So that was a disappointment, but he came in this season with a bang in the Paris-Nice. He and the Rabobank team smashed everybody out of sight early on during the race, and he took the lead and kept it right the way through to the end. One of the men I think could certainly feature in the top half dozen, might even be in the top three. Bogart underway. And after Bogart goes, we go on to Vunikrov of the Casino squad, and then Tonkov, Sulla, Borben, Armstrong, Alano, and Julik. Back out on the road with Richard Veronque. The camera's going round, probably fair way round here. This is a sparse bit for the audience, but we noticed, for us, they've been out chopping the grass and keeping the hedges back and everything for the people to go round when we went round the trip yesterday. So it's made it ideal for the spectators. They're obviously a bit thin here where you can't really see much more than the rider go whisk straight past, but on the climbs and in the finishing area, a big massive turnout. It's going to be hell getting home tonight, I think, because Puy de Fou, this marvellous building, is almost in the middle of no man's land. As we go past the vineyards up on the right, so we spotted that, didn't we, Russ?
No, you spotted the vineyards.
Yeah. Now then, this Vinokurov on his way through now. A lot of people are tipping him the chap who could finish in the top 10 in the Tour de France. He's a young rider, only I think about 21 years of age, and he's really blasted a few people so far this year. In the Dauphiné Libéré, for instance, he was the overall victor of that. He won the second stage in that race and just surprised everybody by his tremendous performance, and he's had that sort of form all the way through the season. He's been popping up all over the place, and I think he's could be in with a shot, but I felt as we watched Vronk now, this is it. Let's see how far Vronk goes up before he flicks the gears. He's out the saddle, really powering up here. And there, that's a quick change of the gears. Now he's down back again because he's got the gear change on the front of the triathlon handlebars. Now he's back down the bottom of the hooks, really bound. This will suit him. This is the part of the course. But again, you have to make a quick change. You have to get this change right. As you change gear, they lose a bit of rhythm on the climb on this prologue stage of the Puy de Fou, covering 6.8 kilometres. Tonkov in the top left-hand side of the screen. The man who's been absolutely schooled to win this race this year as far as Mappe are concerned. A man who's triumphed in the Tour of Italy. There he goes, underway. Pavel Tonkov. Winner of the Tour of Italy in 1996, second in 1997 and 1998, fourth and fifth in the Giro d'Italia as well. What a performance in 6 years, never at the top five in the Tour of Italy. That's been his number one objective. That's why we've not seen him performing in the Tour de France before. But the Mappe team said, right, this is your target for the year. Let's see what he's going to do. As Vronk now struggling a little bit to get to grips with this climb. He's not the world's greatest time trialist, and particularly when it comes to prologue, doesn't seem to have the guts to go. What's the secret of a good prologue time trial, Russ? It seems to be that you blast all the way around and hope when you fall off, you actually cross the finishing line. And this course, then, how would you ride it?
Well, the thing is, taking it from Chris Pullman, because I spoke to Chris earlier in the week, the thing is
it's up to the caps. Alex Zuller now. Now, we're watching here, excuse me interrupting, he won the prologue time trial stage in Sint-Hertogenbosch 3 years ago. Chris Pullman was riding around in the wet that day in Holland, and he was a bit concerned about the wet conditions following his crash the year before. And this man won the prologue time trial. This is Hertogenbosch through very, very wet conditions. He was one of the riders taken out the Tour de France last year, and he seems to have gone a little bit off the boil from his performance in previous years. He won the Tour of Italy in 96 and 97 and was second in Tour de France in 1995. Could be interesting this year. So back then, Richard Vronk, as we've now had Zuller go out of the start house, Bourbon, Armstrong, Alano and Juliet get to go. And this course, which is a rather quick one, but we have nobody top all the time. In fact, the climb 7.50 just got up on the board, and I'm just wondering whether that's right or not. No, it's gone back to 8.20, 8.38. He flicks and catches me out. Back then with Chris Bourbon. Whole of Great Britain will be holding their breath now. Chris could be on the hat trick. He won in Rouen the prologue time trial in 1997. He won the prologue time trial in Dublin in 1998. Now Chris Bourbon's on the way. Can he get the hat-trick? He's dedicated himself to this one this year. He won the prologue time trial in the Paris-Nice back in March. He won the 10.5 Critérium International time trial, beating Alano in that short distance. And he won the Pro Tour over 4.2 miles. That was not actually a prologue time trial. It was part of a split stage on that day. He's been schooling himself totally for this. And when you look at this bicycle, he's got a tremendous set of handlebars, completely moulded black handlebar set that's comes on to front of that unusual look bicycle. And as I say, he's got the Mectronic Mavic system there, pressing the buttons to change gear. The single chain ring at the front. He's not going to figure around trying to drop the chain ring from one ring to another. Bourbon is underway. Zabel then coming in here now. Well, that's not unsurprising because he'll be waiting for the sprint finish tomorrow, finishing 8:46. Well, what do you think about Bourbon's chances, eh?
Well, I've got Bourbon down as actually winning today, but on the start line now we've got Lance Armstrong, US Postal Service.
Fourth last year in the Tour of
Spain, but also he did a fantastic ride in the time trial at the World Championships for his fourth as well.
He was.
And fourth in the road race.
He came good at the back end of the year. He rode well in the Tour of Luxembourg last year. He's been doing exactly the same thing this year. And if this man gets the Tour de France, if he gets on the top three places, it'll be marvellous. If he gets the yellow jersey, it'll be something else. As Bourbon now tries to get the first yellow jersey this year's Tour in the prologue time trial. Vronk then, not exactly his sort of race, this prologue time trial. He's up to specialists blasting round here. You've ridden a few of them in the past, Russell. You know, how do you rate this particular course?
I think this course is very, very difficult. I mean, it's fine for the first sort of, you know, two-thirds until you get to that climb. As soon as you hit that hill and turn right, then it really starts. You really have to dig in deep. But coming back to, as Richard Vronk crosses the line, Coming back to Chris Bourbon on the start line there, we've got Abraham Milano, winner of the Tour of Spain last year, former world road champion, former team time trial champion. A good away from the gun there. Little flick, little bang there, the flick of the gears. But coming back to Chris Bourbon, obviously, it's not been an ideal start of the season. Obviously, he was won the prologue in the Paris-Nice, but also he's had three major crashes. He crashed in the 4 day of Dunkirk, and also in the Pro Tour as well.
So Chris Bourbon had one of those up and down years. He always seems to have, he fell off last year, didn't he? After we came out of Dublin, bang, down he went in the yellow jersey on day one, and that was him out of the race. We're now out with Alano wearing the rainbow bands as the world time trial champion. And I'm glad actually that they've allowed this year the UCI for the time trial world champions to wear their jerseys in other events than a single day time trial. That's very much down to people like Cipollini, who would always try and break the rules and wear the jersey where he wanted to. Bobby Julich now, third last year, and he's going off last because Pantani doesn't want to ride the race. Last year's winner said he wasn't hilly enough for him, and Ulrich can't ride the race because he got a bad knee. So it's opened the way for Bobby Julich to go last of the riders. Moreau, an extremely good time trial. Looks like he might be in with a shout here. We haven't had any intermediate times on our computer, which seems to have gone on holiday. It's the time. There he is, 8:16:48 and 8:17:48. So Moreau has taken the lead now. I'm sorry I didn't give you any of the intermediate time checks because they've not been giving us any information here at all on the screens. I know that the holidays in France started on Friday. I think our computers decided to go with them, and they keep coming on pressing buttons, but I'm sorry about that, all you viewers back at home. One of the great advantages of being on site is you get information. Unfortunately, is the computer seems to have gone on holiday. Back with Bobby Julich. So this is going to be really something else that we've got to try and wonder what's that going out there on the course without any intermediate time checks coming in, unless somehow we give the computer a sharp tap with a hammer. And I'm sure that I met my father when the television set used to go on the blimp, we'd go and hit it with his hand. But in those days, they had valves and things. It will start going again, but not the computers of today. Once they're down, boy, they're down. There we are. That's the position as we've got now. Moreau, Verbrugge and Gonzalez. And further on down, see Brochard has been pushed into fourth spot, main and back, and they're running up to give you most of the top 10 riders. Bobby Julich, a great mountain climber, not the world's greatest time trials, and particularly over a short distance like this one, but he's got to show that he's prepared to give it some steam. He's riding on a brand new bike. We saw this one the other day, didn't we, Russ?
That's right, yeah. Just coming back to the time trial, I believe he was fourth or fifth last year in Dublin.
And there we are, they're back out with Armstrong, and he's also a useful time trialist, so I think he could be going well. And so Armstrong out here, the last but two men to go. We've got them all out on the road now. So what do you see coming in here? Can they topple Morrow's time, 8:17:48? Bogart is not exactly... Whoa, that's a bad one.
That's a real slow time. Just wondering if maybe he punched or something outside of us, but it's a real slow time there for one of the big hitters. If we get to the climb now, Lance Armstrong starting to dance out the saddle, the crowd really getting behind him.
And Vernikov, good ride too. And that would have been about the third spot now at 8:23:20. No, he's a bit further back there, probably at 6. Vernikov then. Bobby Julich, last man out in the road. Behind him would be an enormous flotilla of traffic following him through because everybody's been down in the start. Everyone wants to go around. They will just go out and follow the grand champions. This is the world champion then. He got that jersey in Valkenburg in October last year. Alana also being past road champion. And you may say, why haven't I picked him to be in the top three places when we get to the Champs-Élysées? Well, I'm not always that good at picking race winners, but I've felt over the years that Alano has cracked every time I've seen him ride, or, you know, not every time, because he won the Vuelta in 1998, but he's promised so much. He was fourth in the Tour de France in 1997, but he also had one bad day in the mountains. Sometimes it doesn't really affect his chances, but sometimes it does. Tao Tonkov, a good time trialist at the longer distances, and so here he comes then, could get himself up in the top 10 places, but now he's going to be out by 10 seconds on Moreau, but Moreau will be no threat to him when they get further up into the mountains. I think Tonkov will be just about reasonably happy with that one, but the question is, what could Bourbon be doing out on the time checks, which we're not getting here, by the way. Over the years I've worked here, we've always had a different system has produced the information for us. Now you see here the giant bicycle of Alano with the long seat pin sticking out as he pumps it up that climb. Not the sort of ideal thing, that climb, for people like Alano. And Zulla here is coming inside 8 minutes at the moment. Again, he could provide a surprise. Zulla, superb short distance time. In fact, I think I've got him down to be second on the prognostications. What's he going to do here, Zulla? He's going to take the lead at this rate. And Vorm will have something to aim up for, because 8.08, 8.09. Zulla has now taken the lead. Well, that was tremendous. So Zulla has taken the lead now, and I'm looking in my little round my neck pouch thing, because I've got Zulla down to be in second spot. I've got Borman first, Zulla second, and Armstrong third. So my predictions, as I say normally, time I tip riders like people tip rubbish, not very well. And so Julik on the way out then, on the way through, will be just trying to keep within contact. I'm trying to pick up off one of the radio stations in my ears if I've got the intermediate times coming. Here comes Boardman now. We watched him at Lille catch Leblanc on in 1 minute. Catch him for that. And no, he's can he just do it? Sprint, no, he's not going to get it. Not going to get it. He's beaten it. So Zulla, 8.09, is going to be the winner. I've got it back to front here, because Chris Borman, is he going to get inside the 8.17 of Morrow as he comes towards the line? The clock is showing down. He might not get third, and the 8.17 dead. Oh, in fact, they've got 8.18. So it could be there that he's lying third now. Not exactly. Well, I let my heart rule my head. I like you. If you were saying he's had a few crashes so far this season, Russell, and I'm just a bit concerned that he didn't seem to be firing all cylinders. That thing has proved. What do you think?
Yeah, I've just got him down. I think I've got him down to fourth place. Third place at 5 seconds.
But do you think those crashes and things he's had so far have affected him?
Oh, really? I say he had three major crashes, and two of them we went down. It was a big 100-mile pile-up. As we come back to Lance Armstrong now, 7.54, as he flows into the line.
Could be there. Look at him coming down the finishing straight. He might take the lead. Armstrong thunders through it. What a sight. He's done it! Armstrong has taken the prologue and the yellow jersey. 8.02, that's phenomenal. He's come back from that cancer, from being off his bike, from being out of competition. Now, can this man, Alano, get inside that superb time, that time of 8.02.5 for Lance Armstrong, who could go into yellow at the end of this one? There's just this man now who can beat him, because Bobby Julik, who went off last, is not really on trial list. He may be better on the longer distances, but in reality, it to me says that this is the only man that can topple him. And he doesn't look to be going quite that quickly. We'll get the time clock as he comes round the bend and up towards the finishing straight, where the crowd is waiting, bated breath. My clock is showing 7.46, 7.47, 7.49 at the moment, 7.50 on the clock. You've got it now on your screen as well. As he settles down, the world time trial champion from Valkenburg in October 1989. He'll wear that jersey right the way through to October this year. He's got 2 seconds to do it, and he's not going to do it. And Armstrong will be standing on the side of the road, probably collapse in the arms of his soigneur. Now knows that he's going to get the yellow jersey without being disrespectful to Bobby Julik. That means that they're 8.13. was the time for Alano, and so that puts him into certainly into third spot then. 8.05, 8.02 was for Armstrong, 8.09 for Zulla, 8.13 for Alano, and that dropping back a bit, it means that even now Borman is dropping further back. So I don't have any doubt that the yellow jersey will go to Armstrong at the end of that one. So Bobby Julik coming through into finish, and well, that's it. A quick word then with Stephen Rose, who just joined me. We've just seen Armstrong get that success. Here comes Julik down here. Not a chance for him to do it, but how do you think Armstrong's feeling now?
Well, I reckon quite happy, I reckon, because there isn't very many riders to come now. So
only
Julik to come. So we realise now, of course, Julik isn't going to beat him. So he's first yellow jersey in the Tour de France of 1999, which is an incredible exploit for a guy like Armstrong coming back from where he's coming from.
we're all very pleased about him getting that success now, and we're going to watch this man come across the line here. And so with Julek just going through an 8.30, he'll be quite a fair way down on the general classification, probably in about the 20 odd spot. Our computer's gone on the blink at the moment as he crosses the line then. And we look now back at the victor of the Prologue time trial, Lance Armstrong. Looking then at the slow motion action replay of Lance Armstrong, I've got with me Stephen Roche, who's been out talking to people on the roundabout. I've got this man Armstrong as a possible winner of the race overall. What do you think of that sort of prediction at this stage?
Well, I think if you told me that about 3 months ago, I'd have said, well, being a bit optimistic. But looking at results over the last few months there, coming to the Dauphiné and different races ridden, definitely he has to be considered now as not just being a top five finisher on powers, but definitely in the first three. Now we have, of course, the abandons, or not abandons, the non-participation of Ulrich, Pontani and those guys. So definitely he must be really a force to be reckoned with now.
And of course this year, without it being so mountainous, the chances are that he can stay with the mountain climbers, isn't he? Because you get certain sorts of courses. What's your opinion of the course this year for the Tour?
Well, this year with two long time trials, 57 and 55 kilometres long, it's definitely going to suit a more of a time trial specialist. Armstrong is by no means a time trial specialist, but he's by no means a climber either. Although last year he finished fourth in the Tour of Spain. So that in itself, Tour of Spain is by no means an easy event. So I think myself this year, the way that the profile of the Tour de France is, with the two long time trials, definitely Armstrong, he always winds himself up for the occasion. So I reckon he'd be a very, very good man for the overall classification.
Well, there we are. It's a quick rundown on the top 20 riders that we've had so far in the Prologue time trial, with Armstrong taking the yellow jersey. Tomorrow he'll take that one. We'll wait and see who was the fastest rider up to the top of that climb to get the King of the Mountains jersey on his back. Have you looked at this wonderful site of the Puy de Fou, where they have those wonderful Sonne Lumineers and those wonderful theatre with 800 people taking part, orchestras playing? Absolutely magnificent place to be. Looking back at Lance Armstrong starting, and away he goes. We've seen some shots of the Puy de Fou, Stephen Roche, alongside me. I've been very impressed with the atmosphere here at the start of the Tour and the conversations going on with people. I suddenly feel it's a different sort of Tour this year than we've been on for some time. You know, people out there, and new riders coming through.
Yes, definitely, but the Puy de Fou in itself has always been a very historical and kind of mythic part for Tour de France to start. We saw Tour de France start from here as well, and it was incredible crowds out. Normally get a bit more humid weather, normally get a bit of rain, but they've been forecasting rain here for the last 24 hours that hasn't come yet, so hopefully it'll stay off for the next day or two. But in saying that, the crowds we saw last night at the show, the Tour de France team presentation, like 20,000 people at a Tour de France team presentation, you know, it's very rare to see.
And also that presentation the year before, because they had the same thing. You were there, weren't you? You finished 13th overall in the Tour that year. How did you find the time trial around an almost identical course?
It was practically identical course, yeah. It's a brilliant prologue course. Looking at the distance, you say, well, it isn't really that long. But in saying that, it's a very tight, kind of strongman's race. That's why the likes of Armstrong was able to come through, and Zuli had a good ride as well, contrary to the likes of Boardman, who'll be a pure kind of time trial specialist, but more kind of technical and more flat. But the little bit of hill in the middle of it here really kind of sorts the men from the boys.
How did you find it when you rode up?
Tough.
Stephen Rosen, thanks for joining us here. We're going to talk to you from time to time. We may come back before the end of the programme. Not quite sure how much time we've got left for those you're watching live in the afternoon. I'm David Duffield, alongside me too, Russell Williams, and Stephen Rose just joined us to recap on the day. Stephen will be popping in towards the end. Of course, he joins us once we've had the rest day, we get the Alps and all the proverbial starts to fly, then he'll be coming at us full time. Russell wished to say something. Russ, yes?
Yeah, I'm just worried about now the US Postal Service. Obviously, they've got the inner jersey, but they've got all these flat stages, and if he's going to win in Paris, it's going to be a long time to hold the jersey, 3 weeks.
What's your answer to that then, about the US Postal Service looking after Armstrong?
Well, you know, the Tour de France never won in any one day, but it can be lost on one day. So far, Armstrong, he's had great tours in the past, but always had one day where he goes under. The Tour de France, having the pressure on your back, is very, very difficult. He has a very good team behind him, yes, very complete team, which will be with him in the climbs as well, I think. But at the same time, I think the Tour is a long way from being over yet.
Another good thing with US Postal Service, they've got two great directors with Mark Gorski and Johan Brunel. Obviously, Johan Brunel used to ride for Rabobank and also on Say, so obviously they're going to look after him and give him the right direction.
Well, definitely there's a lot of experience in the team on and off the road, and that will definitely help. And Armstrong himself is by no means a spring chicken. Like, he's been there and done that, so he can look after himself. But definitely in the form he's shown over the last few months, we're kind of saying, well, can he hold that good form? He had it like in the Dauphiné. Normally riders come on form in and around the Dauphiné, but he was really on form in Dauphiné. So it's kind of, it's a question in everybody's mind now. Like, okay, he's performed here now in the Prologue, beaten everybody else. What's he got left, you know?
So, Stephen, in these next few days on these flat stages, what would the US Postal Service be doing? How would they be looking after him?
Well, I reckon that the Psycho team and also with the Telecom team with Zabella, they'd be trying to control the first 5-6 days, definitely up to the first rest day next Monday, so that they'd be able to keep the gaps down so they can sprint, and so that Cipollini can win the maximum amount of stages, because I can guarantee this year Cipollini should finish his first Tour de France.
Well, the sprinting course tomorrow will be very intense, because there's 20 seconds bonus for first, then there's 12, and then there's 8 seconds bonus, and there'll be great determination for people to try and take that yellow jersey. But there again, 20 seconds, I can't think anybody in that top 20 riders. It seems to be the sprint quality, like we saw before with Cipollini when Chris got the jersey in Rouen. Cipollini was roaring because he only went about 14 seconds behind him, wasn't he, at the end of it? So that meant the next day the jersey went. So I think Armstrong, would you set out to defend it that much, or just, as you say, ride behind the sprinters' teams tomorrow? Then it may lose the jersey 2 or 3 days later?
Well, I reckon what they will try and do is they will try and defend first of all on the start of the stage, make sure no kind of wild breaks get away. And then eventually they will probably, slowly but surely, the bigger sprinters' teams will come on board then, in the hope that that their big team leader sprinters can gain stage wins. But I think that the first 50-60 miles tomorrow is going to be very difficult to control. I reckon there'll be a few attacks here and there, because it's still very, very close. But 5 flat days in the next 6 days being very, very flat, I think it's on anyone's race, first of all. Anyone knows that when you get down to the mountain, it's more difficult to actually get a yellow jersey in the back. So there's many riders in there in the first 10 at the moment capable of getting the yellow jersey through sprints and through different things. So I reckon it's going to be a very, very animated first 5 days.
Well, there we are then, Purifu rocketing with that result of Armstrong's. We've just seen Lance Armstrong go past our commentary point here, being rushed off for interviews, and what a day he's had, and what a weekend we've had here too, because we were down there yesterday watching this grand presentation of the teams, and you were there when they presented the teams the first time we were here way back in 93. What's it like to be actually down there in that audience and looking back at that and the atmosphere and all the horses and the people and the pantomime, the whole thing? I shouldn't have put pantomime, it wasn't a joke, it's a tremendous piece of theatre, isn't it?
Oh, definitely, Dave. I mean, now it makes you really understand how actors feel when they're on stage.
We'll stop you here. We've got an interview coming up. It is, for some reason, the sound is not coming through at the moment. And that's a great pity. We'll shut it just in case it comes through to you.
It's incredible. Unglaublich. Tous les problèmes avec moi, tous les... The story, c'est incroyable. Just maintenant, incroyable.
Il peut parler anglais, on traduit. Yeah, he's saying he's just absolutely, incredible what he's just done. Then a big team is very special.
Avant aujourd'hui, je pense. Alors, le premier objectif pour l'équipe est le Tour de France. Le Tour de France, c'est la plus belle course dans le monde.
Yes, he just said the first time he's got the yellow jersey, but the Tour de France is, as far as he's concerned, a team race. And although he's got the jersey, it's the team he's interested in. So this is the main race, of course, for Americans, and therefore, of course, the public follow the race as well.
Et maintenant, accomplish, comme on dit. C'est fait.
C'est fait. Alors, Lance, je vais vous libérer car on.
So he said he's done what he set out to do. He's managed to win the first stage. And there we are then. So Lance Armstrong all the way around. That's very nice of Lance to say that, because he said about the quit, because this is an American team here. They've got a good strength in depth of mainly American riders as well. And who would have thought that when you were riding way back when you started here, that Prologue time trial, we'd see this, the Americans coming through like this?
Well, nobody would have thought it, but at this time, like, because because of different participation of the Americans, the 7-Elevens, the Motorola and so on and so forth, they've finally gotten together a full American team, or almost full American team, and that's why US Post now is probably riding on the back of the all the hard work done by the other teams before them, the other sponsors before them. I think it's great to see it. We would never have thought of it years ago when it was only Greg LeMond and Jonathan Boyer. So it's a fabulous thing altogether.
Well, that's good news, I think, to see a lot of new talent coming through in cycle racing and in Tour de France in particular. We're going to see the podium now as Lance Armstrong comes through to take the plaudits of the crowd. Masses of people have moved from around the start area to move in toward the finish area to stand up in front of that enormously inflatable podium for him to take the flowers of victory. He's won in the past as well as Lance Armstrong, by the way. His first victory he took of the stage victory was when he took the one in 1993, I think it was, at Verdun. That was his first stage victory in the Tour de France in 1993. After the race started here, Lance was riding then, and he went on to take a stage victory. Didn't finish that year in 93. He didn't finish in 94 either. But Lance Armstrong now has got not only the stage victory on his belt, we'll see him shortly getting in the yellow jersey. And that must be a great feeling for any rider. And the disappointment then for Chris Borman didn't quite fire on all cylinders, but I'm sure he'll be the first to congratulate Lance Armstrong. And I think it must be really Steve racing alongside me. There's some, I mean, all bike riders speak to bike riders, but the bike riders have got a tremendous respect for this man, haven't they?
Well, they have, because initially when he arrived in Europe, he was very arrogant and very big-headed about everything. And then he realised during his illness, he realised how much cyclists and fellow cyclists actually respected him and felt for sad and sorry for what had happened to him and really helped and supported him during his illness. So now he's come back now totally different and appreciates that, well, cycling is a game, it's a sport, it's a job. But at the same time, lads out there, they can't just kind of give you a present of a win here and there. It's a job, it's dog eat dog, but at the same time, there's a human side of it. And Lance Armstrong has finally seen the human side of it, I think. And now he's respected immensely by everybody, but especially coming back from where he's come from.
So there he is now, that man who's got all that respect of the peloton and the public, now taking the yellow jersey in the Tour de France. He's had stage victories before in the Tour, but this must be a wonderful moment for him. And certainly there's camera crews here from America. They'll be beaming these pictures out to the Americans. They'll be waking up to the fact that the grand champion here has taken the yellow jersey on day one in the Tour de France. The prologue time trial at Puy-de-Fou, 6.8 kilometres of flat-out effort. And it was Armstrong that went round in just a fraction over 8 minutes. 8.02 was his time. And Armstrong takes yet again the applause of the crowd. And the sun has come out on a glorious day's racing, and this really has given us a wonderful start to the 1999 Tour de France. And there's no doubt about it, there's some great action yet to come up live on Eurosport for the next 3 weeks. The Puy-de-Fou has seen some spectacles in its time, but what a spectacle we had today when Armstrong romped through to take the victory and the yellow jersey. Well, tomorrow we're going to be moving on to Monteau-Chalon, and it's going to be quite a reasonable day. You can see there on your screens maybe a little bit of rain earlier on. The sun will then come out on the route, to which takes them 208 kilometres on the first stage of the race. We're bringing you that back end of that race live on Eurosport, and as you can see, it isn't very hilly at all, just an undulating sort of route they're going to have tomorrow. So in reality, it could be down to the sprinters to provide us the entertainment on stage two of the race. Then looking back then at Lance Armstrong, who's got that victory today under his belt. And tomorrow then, as Stephen Roche was saying, it will be one that the sprinter teams might control and could play right into his hands. But you can only find out by watching us live on Eurosport. Today we've had the company of Stephen Roche giving an update towards the back end. My good friend Russell Williams alongside me will be with me back again tomorrow to bring you the stage when Lance Armstrong will be in yellow. And the first thing anybody wants to do is to shake his hands on that superb performance which has taken him into yellow on day one of the Tour de France. Look forward to your company then tomorrow at 4 o'clock Central European time, 3 o'clock in the UK. Bye-bye.
The Tour de France.
A lot of Richard Varonc supporters out there in the crowd. What a lot of pressure that man had just there at the prologue.
Now then, he's getting nearly caught. What's the gap on your screen?
It's 1 minute 41 seconds now. He's down. He's starting to blow. And there's nothing else he can do, Dave. There's no point in him sitting up. He must just give it all he can and get maximum publicity.
Hey, this is the sign we saw today as we went past.
Yes, it was. And what happens when the arrows are further down, eh?
This is the bit I actually wrote it down. I made a little note. We came past here at about all. Just in this village up here, there's the arrows that we're supposed to follow for the Tour de France. Someone's actually moved them, and if you actually follow the arrows, you will go straight into someone's garage.
Yeah, they're getting toward the point, and we saw them. We almost turned right into this bloke's garage. It reminded me of the time when the Pro Tour last year, somebody followed the wrong arrows, they ended up in a supermarket. Were you there, Russ?
Hey, I won't have you saying bad things about the Prudential.
I'm not saying nothing to do with the Prudential. It was a bloke who put the arrow, or nicked the arrow, or probably turned it round and pointed to the wrong place. So that happened last year, and anyway, it's happened in many other races when the arrows have gone the wrong way round for some reason, some devilry amongst the spectators, but let's hope they turn right without any trouble. Well, the main pack getting very much closer. It's coming down all the time to this poor one sole rider out there in the front, and all you people back at home, give him a round of applause when he gets caught then, because I think his days are numbered. It's Gouvenot, went away after 63 kilometres on this stage one of the Tour de France, covering 208 kilometres in all today, and the crowd at the finish line beginning to gather up and wondering to see who'll get the stage victory. Looks like it could be a sprinter, but who will it be? That's a question you can find on Eurosport. Yes, Russ.
Yeah, another good thing is actually, it stopped raining here, the roads are starting to dry up, so we're going to have an excellent sprint. Be interested to see who's going to win, either my man Mario Cipollini or your man Jimmy Casper.
Yeah, well, he's surprised people already, Casper, and in the Tour of Germany, he got something like about four stages, and he's beating people like Eric Sarbel on his home territory. So he rides for the La Française des Jeux. It's a fairly whitish-coloured jersey, so that's the one to look sprinter from Francis Deschamps.
But the thing is with Jimmy Casper, he's got an excellent man in, is it Lars Mikkelsen, the Dane, is it, who's in the team who won the World Cup a few years ago? A perfect leader man, a big guy, can get him to the last 200 metres and let Casper do the rest of the work.
Yeah, because what's happening now with the sprinters is that people like Cipollini and Steels and Jalabert in his day, all these sort of backing off the sprinting, they've at Zabel, they've all known each other for some time. They've got Zabel and Steele and Cipollini charging down the line. They sausage that very well indeed. Up comes these new young sprinters. I remember in the Tour of Italy this year, when young Quaranta, I think it was stage two he had been watching Cipollini in the sprints, and he discovered that when Cipollini was being led out by the Psycho team, Cipollini would occasionally look to the left, and always look to the left. And so, you know, the gap's come down now. 1:40 it is then for Gouvenot. Let's hope he gets there, but still I think we're going to have a sprint with him. And this lad, because he's ex-junior sprint champion of the world, watched Cipollini go left, look left with his head. And coming down one of these finishing straights, the minute Cipollini's head went left, he went right. And I thought, that's exactly what sprinters do. Now, Casper is probably the same mold, because he's another little sprinter chap. So there's two young chaps now. Casper... McEwen, he's been about, last year he's been sprinting with him anyway, but Quantra, who could catch people on the hop. So now in this race, Jimmy Casper will be amongst a lot of other riders who may not see much of him except from the back when he's passed them. And he wears a sort of whitish coloured jersey on the top with greyish coloured shorts, so we'll have to watch out for him. And there you can see the white and the bluish short. I think that's the lads from Mappe going through, the blue shorts. You have to be careful picking out the whites, very similar for the France Adieu. France Adieu is more over on the right, I think. Those are the greyish shorts just going now up the front. So they're getting near the front. That's La France Adieu. Mappe don't seem to be doing too much. Difficult our camera here to pick out the... Oh, gosh, the French are going mad. Because we've Gouvenot gone down, and I'm not surprised then. But when we go back there, we'll try and pick out some of the colours for it before we get down to the hurly-burly of the sprinter, some of the sprinters, to see what they might be able to do. Yes, Russ?
Yeah, Gouvenot's really starting to labour now. He's got the big gear on, but he's really having difficulty trying to turn it over. He's on the left-hand side of the road trying to hide from the wind. There's nowhere hiding now. That peloton's really going to bring him back.
He's nodding, isn't he?
Yeah, he's really starting to bob and weave now. He's been out there 110 kilometres or more?
About that. Well, he went up to 63 kilometres of the race for cover when he shot off. Yes, Rush.
Yeah, he's got his mouth wide open. He's really trying to get the air, you know, as much oxygen as he can in there.
He's always in a hot day. He might get a lot of flies because we've lots of cows on the side, and always where there's cows, you get lots of flies, but not today.
Hey, nice shot. Hey, that could be Kent. That could be Tunbridge Wells. Yeah, looks beautiful.
Well, don't forget years gone by that England, Britain was attached to Europe. You look at old not maps, but how they thought the world evolved. We were actually stuck to this part of Europe. You see where it sort of broke away. So down from the south, down from Kent, down to Brittany, down that part, we seem to be wedged into there. So it's very much similar to being back at home.
You know, I was just looking there as we look at the gap now, it's down to 1 minute 12. I was just looking there at Francis Dujour. I'm sure they've got another sprinter. Damien Nelson, another good.
Yes, he is, but he's not the same standard as Damien Nelson. No, he's not the same standard as Casper by any means.
No, he may not be the same standard, but it's good to have a lot of fast people around you for the last few kilometres. So your man might be in with a chance, but I still have Cipollini down as a win.
Well, Cipollini's wearing the red and the white colours of the Psycho team. You can see them in there. If you see some purple and pinky coloured jerseys coming forward, those are lads setting it up then for the Serrada Specialist Sprinter. And looking through there, they're all sorts of different colours coming through, aren't they? Then also the yellow jersey won't be far at the front, he'll stay around about 20. This is the La Française de Jour team colour, I told you, how they're sort of whitish tops and greyish shorts. Begin to set up for Jimmy Casper. The red and white behind for Psycho Cannondale, just also driving it forward. They don't want anybody to jump away in these final 2 kilometres. The people like to go for a long one. Though I think they're saying, look, there's a crash. I heard it coming up on the right, an enormous crash. This is the danger. Let's see if anybody, especially, has been brought down in that one. I'll get my headphones up now on the radio tour, and we're looking at it again in slow motion. It's about a third of the way back. About 16 riders, they say, are down there, and this is going to be a big problem. Let's look to if any of the star boys have gone down, and the arms are going up there. It looks like a good collection of different riders. Well, one of the Psycho riders, but the top men would have been up near the front, I think. So he's going back into the race then, and that is Samaron from the Vitalis Seguros team. Quite a number of the Lotto riders have come down in this one, and that's is 86 Van der Vuva that's come down. It looks like this Psycho rider is in a bit of trouble. They're all trying to get spares, but he's bust his, bent his handlebars around that Lotto rider. A couple of Lotto riders really in trouble. What a mess. And they're now, because what's happened is, I think the number one team cars have gone forward, and they're waiting now for the second team cars to come forward, and the doctor's coming to, is he going to ride? Yes, he is. Now he's had to take his bike off the second team car, because the number one team cars have stayed up here near the front with the top men, because normally that happens when that's towards the back end of the race. That's the lesser riders who are back there right now. All the top men have got to be near the front. They've got to stay out of trouble. Keep your fingers crossed.
Back to the highlights of today's stage of the Tour de France. And just before we go back to David and the action, you've heard him and the rest of the lads mentioning Cipollini quite a bit, and there he is, the man himself, seen in Montaigu in his car prior to the start of this particular stage. As you recall, the weather was rather inclement, and like most of the riders, Cipo was waiting inside to keep as dry and as warm as he possibly could before getting out of the car and getting to the start line. Of course, the team manager's Guido Bontempi now, the Seiko team manager, 5 times a stage winner in the Tour himself, and he was asked about Mario and what his feelings were, because it looked as though he was rather quiet in the car there. And Guido said, well, he's got to try to win this stage in order to take time bonuses and maybe the yellow jersey. And the question was, well, how is he? Looks like he's not having much fun this morning. No smile and no comment. And Guido said, well, it's perhaps not his normal behaviour, but he's really calm and confident underneath. He's just concentrating on thinking of the race ahead, thinking only about the race, focusing on it, and that's why he's not talking a lot. Although I suspect that he was probably thinking, oh, not a day in the rain. Anyway, the great Guido Bontempi, 5 times a winner of stages in the Tour de France. Anyway, as we watch those pictures of the Seiko team and Cipo going to the start, it's time for us to go back now to the action.
Look again then at the crash as it comes down here, and they've just said the number 12, Damien's, has been coming up on our headphones. Well, he's won a stage in the Tour de France in the past as someone dived into ditch, and this again is the problems that you get when you're racing at this sort of level, that the riders are just, even at their high professionalism, somebody just touches the wheel and down they go. So it's only 50 seconds now is the gap between the... No, it's only 50 seconds on my headphones now between the leader and the main group, so he's going to get followed back up again. And we'll see lots of chase groups coming through as the little groups arrive, delayed in that crash, will work together to come back. And this actually will work in their favour, I think, those people who crashed off, because once they catch Gouvenot, the steam will go out of it a short while, and I think there'll be almost a gentleman's agreement that they won't go too quick and allow these other riders to come up and get back in the pack, because that was a sheer accident. it wasn't anything that they would like to have happen to themselves. I think they'll just, once they catch this man here, they'll just ease back a little bit and just keep the pace, control the front. They'll keep the order. It's a bit like, I suppose, in a motor race, when they bring out the lead car with the flashing lights, the safety car comes out, as we've been seeing in Formula 1, that most exciting Formula 1 race we had the other week. I watch a bit of Formula 1 and sometimes sort of bore, I even drop off to sleep, but that was a cracking race in the rain, and enjoyed watching that, particularly when the safety car came out and the flashing lights. Well, I think we'll have the same thing here, that when they get Gouvenot back in the pack, they'll put the safety car in the shape of the psycho man of the chap from France de Jour on the front at not too fast a speed, and give the chance to back to come back. It's a sign, you see, they're not going too quickly, because this aloe head is very short and wide, the front, and then it runs down the back where they get very close to the grass verges, and so many riders are now compacted behind. That's not a sign that they're going flat out, and so the other groups, the other lads behind can come. What's it do, though, Russ, when you crash like that? Not only from the injuries you get, but psychologically, I mean, how do you get yourself back in, or do you just lose your temper?
Well, no, the thing is, there's no point losing your temper. I mean, if you crash, I mean, the thing they always taught me in Belgium is call it the Belgian waffle. If you crash, try to find another rider to land on, because it's softer. If you can't crash on the grass, don't hit the concrete, just land on somebody else. And the thing to do is, if you land on somebody else, by the time you get up and change your wheel, they've got to do theirs so you can chase together.
I remember in the Tour of Italy when there was a crash. No, Tour of Ireland, sorry, there was a crash I was riding in, and the poor one of the Irish lads was completely knocked out on the side of the road, and Ted Gerrard had crashed as well, and Ted was quite a wide boy. I'm sorry, Ted, if you're listening to this, but you're a great character. Anyway, Ted had crashed down as well, and he smashed his front wheel, and he looked around, and there was this Irish lad, completely unconscious. So he took the front wheel out the Irish lad's bike, and then rode off down the road with a good front wheel. But I don't know how the Irish lad did when he woke up and discovered that he'd got a busted front wheel, as well as a bad head. Yeah, only 35 seconds. They're going to catch him.
They're definitely going to catch him. But going back to that crash, I noticed one of the psycho guys went down, but remember last year in Dublin when Cipollini crashed, didn't he? When, you know, did he crash in Dublin last year?
He did. They came down the finishing straight, and they were still about 20th off the front, or even perhaps less than that. And one of the chaps just away, the train was going. They were probably second train in line. And down went Cipollini, and then he got back up again. And of course, later on, he got himself his stage victory. So that's what the sprinters know. They know that crashing is something they have to put up with, and we'll wait and see if they come down in one big heap or keep themselves upright on the sprint, which is certainly going to happen a bit further down the road. So this man, Gouvenot, so 106 and 3 are the two of the numbers that are just coming through to me that have been brought down in the group behind, and yep. So they've got those two riders off the back. Capinotti of Lamprey has come down, and also number 3 Davion has still yet to get back in the main pack. You've got some more names there?
Yeah, I've got.
Yeah, we've got, because Demarbeck's is coming, and we've got Davion, we know he's back then.
Pinay?
Back on the bike.
Pina.
And Lefebvre is down there. Salmeron has also gone down, and Demarbeck and Davion. So they're going to have to try and come back now. That crash happened at about 183 kilometres of racing. We've got 208 kilometres in all. It won't be long before they see the 20 kilometre to go sign, and it looks like we're in them for a phenomenal bunch sprint finish. That main pack not going eyeballs out right now, which give the chaps who crashed a chance to come back. There are about 187 kilometres of racing covered so far today, so we're getting into about 30 kilometres to go, and it looks to me as if it's going to be one of those days when the sprinters will licking their lips. And people like Alex Armstrong in the yellow jersey, providing he can keep out of trouble, we saw that crash back there, he would be up near the front, will be happy, I think, that a sprinter gets the stage today, because his time gap between himself and Zulup is only 7 seconds, Alano 11 seconds, Molo 4 seconds, Bourbon 16 seconds, but none of those, I think, could out-sprint Lance and get the 20 seconds bonus at the end of it all. So it's been a good day for the team from the US Postal Services to control the race all the way through and bring it back together just about the right time. But I have a suspicion one or two of the teams who don't have a top sprinter with them will be just getting a bit irascible and just jumping off down the road, and the top sprinters team will have to start going a bit quicker to try and make sure that nobody splits away. Still, Gouvenot receiving almost a hero's welcome as he goes along here, because He went away after 63 kilometres of racing. Let's say he gets caught now, he will have had, 208 less 93. He's done something like 110 kilometres of on the lead. Just a little note coming out of our headphones concerning Casera, the champion of Spain. Oh, he's punctured. Casera's just punctured and his teammates have dropped back to him. Well, he should be able to get back. He's twice champion of Spain, and the speed isn't too much, I don't think, for him. So Casera should get back. Just had that puncture just down the road. And his team will drop back to help him. We might have a picture off one of our motorcycles towards the back, because they like picking that up as the field going along here at a reasonably slow rate, no problem at all. Now you can pick out some of the colours here, and even your eyes can very clearly show you what the team colours are. The Cofidis boys there with the blue shorts, the red, white and blue top to it. The Once colours are black and yellow. The red and yellow and black just are in front. That was the team from Lotto. We're back here with Big Matt Albert, 93, Gouverneau. Let's see. No, it's down to 27 seconds, so he's only got 27 seconds lead, and they'll certainly be able to see him on the straight road, and they're just biding their time to pull him in, and then that'll be that as far as he's concerned. But a very sympathetic crowd along the way. There is each day a special prize for the rider, for what they call the Grand Prix Combativity. It's a prize which is given for the rider who is the most aggressive during the day, and I think I know already where this one's going to. And at the end of the stage, the judges sit and decide who will get it, and in the Tour de France village tomorrow they will give the award. It's the judge comprised of Jean-Marie LeBlanc, the Director General of the Tour de France, Jean-François Péchaud, the Director Sportif of the Tour de France, Bernard Hinault, who is one of the technical consultants, Jean-Paul Bruchon, who works for France Info, and Philippe Bouvet, who writes for L'Equipe, Gerard Holtz, who's the a joint director for the French television, and Charlie Marty, who's the assistant director, of course. They all decide on the Grand Prix de la Combativity, and tomorrow he will get his prize. I'm sure it's going to go to this particular man. He will then also, by the way, get a different number on the back. If he guesses, I think he might do. That number there, the white number with the black letters on, it changes, and they put a red number on tomorrow for the man who's leading on the Grand Prix de Combativity. So if you're watching on next stage, and you come and watch with us on stage two, see a bloke with a red number on, that's the bloke who won the award. They've had to snap him up, I think. Last year was Jackie Durand who won it, and guess who was in second spot? Andrea Tappi. So it often goes to what we call gutsy riders. Riders are prepared to just go and go and go and ride hard and entertain the crowd and frighten the peloton sometimes, and that's just what Gouverneau has done today. The main peloton, bottom of your screen, and just up in the middle of your screen, the lonely figure of Gouverneau about to be swallowed up. Let's hope he doesn't get spat out the back, by the way, because the main pack often accelerate when they catch a lone rider like this, and when they catch him, then he's dying a thousand deaths. You know, he's just freewheeling now. He's done something around about 70 miles in English money out at the front of this race on his own. Maximum lead he had was 6 minutes and 45 seconds just after the feeding station, when he still had some 60 miles to go. And if they catch him now, he's got about 30 kilometers left. He just didn't quite make it. So let's have a round of applause for him. There's a tax go away. That's attack. I told you what's happened. This is why they don't like to catch them too fast. And away they go. It's Dixon's. We might have known it. The Dixon's with the man to go. This is typical Dixon's tactic. And they're going to do this Lamprey, actually, because they wanted to have the other sprinters' team chase Dixon down. Because in that case, it's a beautiful move by Lamprey to go down the road. So people like Zbigniew Spruch and Jan Smerale, both of them work very well together in the sprints, could now have to sit back and the other team could do the chase. What a tremendous piece of activity by this man who was really a semi-pro for a few years, and then he got a bit more money. He was still a sprayer in the Duff factory, and then he got a bit more money, went for the Lotto team, but only went riding criterions. Rode very well last year, he did loan breaks, rode like this, and now Dixon is doing his usual typical tactics. But it's a very straight road coming in here, and soon when we swing onto the main road with 9 kilometres to go, you can see at least about a 5 minute gap down the road. So I don't think he's got much chance here, but it's quite exciting.
Yeah, it's a good move there by Dirks. But what they actually say is when you've got a national championship jersey on your back, it gives you sort of an extra 20% as he sits down in the tuck position now. All he can do is bury himself now. He's committed himself, and this is it.
Well, there he is then, wakening up the main pack behind, and certainly they will know they've got their work cut out, because they know this man and they know how he's quite likely to go off and hold this lead. And let's see then what he's likely to do. Can he hang on to it?
Our highlights of today's stage of the Tour de France. And just before we rejoin the action with David and the rest of the guys, a look back to Thierry Gouvenou, who himself was looking back there, and a little word of explanation from him after the stage that we managed to get about that break. He said, well, I had to try something. We've got 8 or 9 or 10 days perhaps on the reasonably flat stages, and now of course you've got to do something good on the flat stages. Maybe I attacked too soon, but I don't regret having a go. There were several other attacks, he says. The US postal team was trying to control it, and I just took advantage of the situation to take my chance. It's often when leaders' teammates are working like that it's time for someone else to have an attack. Unfortunately, I was on my own. I didn't have any help. Well, it was a good attack whilst it lasted, and it gave everyone a lot to talk about. Anyway, he was caught. The race moved ever closer to the finish. Time for us now to rejoin the action with David.
Against the edge of the grass verge on both sides, the main pack coming in now. They'll be shortly seeing the 3 kilometres to go, and you see the Mappe rider right at the front there, beginning to set up for Tom Steels. Interesting not to see him in his Belgian national championship jersey. One of the things about commentating the Tour de France, you've got to get knowing all the new national coloured jerseys. The riders switched them just before we came in the championship just a week ago. So can Tom Steels get the victory coming inside those last 2 kilometres to go? Sorry, three it is, three on the they then some run off up and run in towards the town, and a little bit of sharp bend in the last kilometre, which can be rather difficult indeed. Picking out some of the colours, the red ones for Psycho Cannondale, setting it up then for Mario Cipollini, and they really are working out. These are typical tactics of the team, well drilled in this sort of thing. I can see a green jersey coming through in the background, because even O'Grady might be chirping up to try and have a go at this one, but I think it might, as Stephen Roche was saying, be a bit out of his class. The lightest coloured, whitest jerseys are the white colours of the La Française des Jeux, and that means Jimmy Castle will be in that jersey. Watch out for him. The orange and white colours, that's the Rabobank team, and that will be the team riding for McEwen. The red and yellow colours are those of Casino, with Kersey Pugh. We'll keep it a bit late. And in fact, oh no, he's got the national championship jersey on. Just correct me on that one. I'll have to check these things with 2 kilometres to go then. As the rest of the boys, way back from 30th back, won't have a chance at all in this one. They'll now be watching as they spring up and come in toward the back end of it. Still then, as Comasso comes through, the national champion of Italy for the Psycho Cannondale team. This is going to be some humdinger. Well, Russ, what's it to be like in the middle of a sprint like that one, eh?
Well, the thing is, if you're in the top 15, you've got a good chance. You've really got to hold your nerve. Right, here we got a left hand bend. All the big boys are going to be up there. Steels is right near the front, so is Cipollini. They've really got to be at the front. But what's going to happen is you're going to be getting hit from left and right, and you've really got to stay on your teammate's wheel.
So, any numbers out there? It looks to me like Big Magnus Baxter has gone the front then, towing along O'Grady. You see the green shorts there. That's a Crédit Agricole team. Not too many teams have got more than two riders left. Are they coming in through now? Trying to set this one up. Still anybody's race. You'll find the yellow jersey will keep out of trouble. Left-hand side, Cantino Tolla starting to go for Minali. Cantino Tolla, Minali on the left-hand side. Coming across Silly, Lamprey, Dyking boys trying to shut this one down. And Cipollini stuck right in the midst of this. It's all over the place. Pushing, shoving, ducking and diving. One coming to go. Sharp right-hand turn yet to come then. And O'Grady goes on the front a bit early, I'd have thought then, but he knows about this right-hand turn, might suit it still. Cantino Tolo going through, two men, and Minali's on the wheel. Minali's in there, and I think he's got Cipollini right behind, and Cipollini recognised Minali might be a danger coming down here. And Minali then has got to, looks over his shoulder, can he see where Cipo's got to? We can't see a thing with the camera. As then off goes the front, as it's one of the big Matt Overvillier riders going through. And still have they come in here, and still O'Grady tries to get this one coming through O'Grady, and it's a determined effort by Big Matt. They've been in the frame all day today, and he's not going to make it. He's dying 1,000 yards, so O'Grady's gone far too soon. O'Grady looks back. Is anybody got his back to the left-hand side? And O'Grady, and he looks up and says, where have you got to then? And my mistake, it was, in fact, Vogel's on the far side. Vogel's on the far side. O'Grady's still in there with a shout, and thumping up on here, Tom Steele's on the inside, trying to get this one outside. Going for Jimmy Casper on the line. As he gets it? No, he wasn't. It wasn't. He didn't get that one. That went to Kersey Pugh, took it on the line, and Casper slowly but then faded as Curtibu burst from the pack and took that victory. Well, what a lot of action we had all over the place, and riders getting the wrong place the wrong time as far as the team from Crédit Agricole were concerned. But Curtibu was that notched up his 15th victory of this season, and he did it fine. So let's watch again as he goes through here. Curtibu and Zabel just on the right hand side trying to hold his wheel, couldn't quite make it as the champion let himself fly across the line. Again, 15th victory season, Jan Kersipu, what a phenomenal sprinter. Zabel just on his wheel, Tom Steele's across there. We'll have to wait and see what happened with young Casper, who seemed to come rather. This is a bit running back now. On the right-hand side, there's Tom Steele's with the blue pants. Then through goes Kersipu in the blue, black and white. Zabel tracks him down and comes through. Look at this in the ladder left hand. Sure, that's Casper. Taking off. He had to slow. He comes up here. He comes up on the side. He left it far too late. And so victory goes to Kersipu from Tom Steele, from Zabel. And I think that might have been O'Grady into fourth spot. But my goodness, if Mr. Casper got himself in better place before, I think he just... you're quite right, Steve, what you're saying. This is a different ball game, isn't it, Tour de France sprinting, eh?
The Tour de France sprint starts about 25 kilometres out. Whereas in some of the... look at him. Gasper going to right-hand side of the road, which is him switching across. David, even though we were saying earlier on he's going to find it difficult, the way he sprinted in that sprint, Dave, we might even see him getting a stage win before we get to the mountains. Because I spoke to Mark Madio this morning, and he was telling me that Casper's may only do the first 8 to 10 days. He's not pushing him to finish the Tour de France because he is only 21 years of age. So they'd be very happy if he can ride the first 8 days for experience, maybe win a stage, but he's not going to push him at all to go to the mountains.
Well, he would gain experience with that, wouldn't he? Because undoubtedly, he looked to be one of the fastest sprinters. They just got in the wrong place the wrong time, didn't they? Eh?
Well, it's a long time, Dave, since you've seen a sprint starting so far out. We saw every one of the big teams got involved there in the lead up into the sprint. So definitely sprints like that we don't see every day of the week.
Well, there we are. It went to Kersipu. Tom Steele taking second and Zabel into third spot.
Sprint there for the line, as predicted by many of us. And Jan Kersipu, we managed to catch up with him as soon as he'd got his breath back. One day, one Tour de France stage, and it's done. Well, he says, yes, I've been working for several years to win a stage of the Tour de France. I got a second place 2 years ago, and today I had good legs, so I thought it must be today or never. And of course, my teammates helped me a lot, Pascal Chanteur and Stéphane Barthes particularly. I was very well positioned after the last bend, and I was able to hold on very well. Well, Jan Kersipu, says our questioner, you've won a lot of stages this year, the Tour of Spain, for example, you've won a lot of the French Cup events, but everybody thought that you weren't going to be able to win a Tour de France stage. So today, you've made them eat your words, haven't you? And he says, well, I thought I'd been able to win a Tour de France stage for the last couple of years, but I perhaps wasn't confident enough. Perhaps I was always too stressed before the finish, and so overawed by the main sprinters. But today, I really did feel good. Yesterday, I did a very good time trial, and that I thought was a sign that I was going well, and perhaps I was in for a good day today. You know, says our questioner, that you were right to do a good time trial, because we've just heard, he says at that time, that you've also taken the green jersey. Well, says Kersipu, that's a good thing. I didn't know about that, but my first goal really was to win the stage. Anyway, now I'm going to have to try to hang on to that green jersey for as long as possible. But there's a yellow jersey around, isn't there? And at the end of the day, it was still firmly on the shoulders of US Postal's American Lance Armstrong, the man from Texas. The green jersey, of course, did go, as we just heard, to Casino's Jan Kersipu. And that's something for him to go out and defend over the next day or two, of course. And meantime, Lampre's Mariano Piccoli, thanks to a second place on that fourth category climb, he was able to hang on to the King of the Mountains. So a quick check on the stage result. Jan Kersipu, of course, winning, and everybody had timed in at the same time. Just ahead of Steele's, Zabel, O'Grady. Martinella was up there. Jimmy Casper, still only 21 years of age. Nicolò Minelli, who was the last to finish in the prologue. And there we see that stage once again. Let's take a little look at it. And we've tried to pick out Kissapur there. You saw the arrow pointing him out. He came from behind and led it out for the last 200 metres. And this really was a long one for him to take on. And yet he had the strength to stave off his nearest challengers, Zabel and Steels. Steels and Zabel was the order in which, of course, they finished. Now a look at the overall ranking, and no change really after that bunch sprint, although you will see up into sixth place, that is the one big jump. Kissapur, of course, have got 20 seconds bonus and 4 seconds out on the sprints, which have helped him enormously. So, Jan Kissapur, the hero of the day, and wearing his champion's jersey with pride as he just inches ahead of Steels and Zabel. And we caught up with Stephen Roach afterwards, himself no stranger to the Tour de France, of course, a former winner, and asked him about it.
15, 20 riders maybe getting 10 minutes up, but the US Postal team defended very well this morning, starting the stage. We saw a breakaway group with Thierry Gouvieu, who later won the Combativity Award, but and then we saw all the sprinters teams then coming together in the final 45, 50K, bringing it to a bunch sprint here in Nantes.
And so a look ahead to tomorrow when we go from Chalons on a pan-flat course to Saint-Nazaire. I say pan-flat, but in actual fact, there is one little climb towards the end, of which more later. The weather forecast, well, what the chance of an odd shower, maybe a similar sort of weather that they've had today. But what does Stephen Roach think about tomorrow's stage?
Tomorrow's stage, Chalons-Saint-Nazaire, 176 kilometres, another very, very flat stage here in Brittany. I think the weather tomorrow is going to play a big part because we're going to have some wind coming in from the Atlantic, and it's going to make the race very, very nervous. And of course today with Lance Armstrong winning his, holding on to his yellow jersey, the sprints, intermediate sprints tomorrow are going to be very, very attractive to the likes of Kissapur, who is getting now only 16 seconds to the yellow jersey.
Well, you'll be able to keep up with the action here on Eurosport tomorrow. Join us at 1500 hours CET, that's 2 o'clock in the UK, and highlights later on in the evening. Till then, goodbye.